Yogi ko, nga nung di man ka. Uyugi na ko, bisan dili ko guapa. Kahibalo ko, musto ya sa kaagi sa una. Sa mga bayani, nakigira lang para sa kuma. Iso mo dasma, handa mo away mamatay. Unsa ka pa, umanggi atay. Kuyog ilagi ko, di man ko mamugos. Kuyog ang muka ko sa kagahapon ni umabot. Kuyog ilagi ko, di man ko mamugos. Kuyog ang muka ko sa kalayo ni tupas. Andang kaupan ang subo para malikawas kuyog ni magkuyog na ta, pagdali na diha. Ngano di ay, ngano di man kaganahan. Kupta na to, ang sundang nila pulapo. Leon kilat, Flores agar kacho. Handa mo away mamatay. Ulipon sa kukma, kukmang di atay. Kuyog ilagi ko, kaman kumamukos. Kuyog ang muka ko sa kaga, ako ni umabang. Kuyog ilagi ko, kaman kumamukos. Kuyog ang muka ko sa kalayo ni kupas. Andam dao ba ng subo para malingkawas kuyog nimo. Hindi ko nimo kuyogan, inuntik kang talawan. Hindi nakakatilaw sa humba o kinilaw. Kuyog ilagi ko, di man ko mamugos. Kuyog ang muka ko sa kagahapon ni umabang. Kuyog ilagi ko, di man ko mamugos. Kuyog ang muka ko sa kalayo ni tupas. Ang damdaman ang sumpon para malingkawas kuyog ni kuyog nimo.
Kaning litanya, kabahining bisda kong paghigugma. Para buyag, kasing-kasing kiat. Para buyag, abdik pa ni Leon kilat. Pagpanggaho gay, paspuso sa larsyan. Muhumuk, igbahog sa baw sa linarang. Humukog ilong, tanalaag tas kulon. At tuon, tadapit nga makasaysayon. Lapik sa dila, ugrot siya sa pulong. Dugan mo siguradong makumong kumong. Hugot pa suot, hugot pa suot. Hugot pa suot.
Bahalag saging, basta labing. Bahalag buwan, basta tupad. Bahalag tuyo, basta with you. Bahalag inamos, basta langgakol. Bahalag hilaw, basta ikaw. Bahalag corny, basta perme. Bahalag lanay, basta tanday. Bahalag dukot, basta lang hugot. Hugot pas huot. Hugot pas huot. Kasing-kasing kapuno sa kahimuon. Huot pas huot. wala'y magbuot. Hugot pa't huot, hugot pa't huot. Bisag ipadpadman sa tumang kalimot. Huot pa't hugot, hugot pa't hugot. Sa dalan kulon, kita mag-abot. Bahala tiit, basta sikit. Bahalag mag-umos, basta lang timos. Bahalag muloong, basta muhaong. Bahalag di makaya, basta kita.
Hindi ka biyaan, tuuradyod na ako. Mura General Maxilum ni ikon mo plano. Para ni mo makipatay ko pareho. Sa Cebuanong katipunerong si Alejo. Maglisod ko kaon, kung di tadungan. Ang imong istorya, murag musika sa dunggan. Bisagin sa nga babae, di ti kailisan. Kaya nga akong gugma, solid pa sa katipunan.
Hugot pa't huot, hugot pa't huot. Kasing-kasing kabuno sa kahimuot. Huot pa't hugot, hugot pa't hugot. Ikaw akong forever, wala'y magbuot na.
Palmgrass, the Cebu Heritage Hotel, in partnership with the Tres de Abril Foundation Incorporated, the Central Visayas Association of Museums, the Diandi Heritage Center, the University of San Carlos Carolinian Political Science Society, the Island Rescue Organization, and the SOAN 2020 present to you this afternoon this very exciting heritage event, I Am, the Dogs in Philippine, in Visayan history. So, dayang salamat again, once again. So, we're so happy that you are with us this afternoon. And this is our first very well-attended event that we only had about 20 or about those number in the past. But this is a very exciting topic. It's the first time that we discuss the history, our relationship with dogs throughout history. And we go back to 4,000 years ago. So we thank those on site who are with us this afternoon. We also we thank the organizations who are with us. So we have those who registered online and who said that they would be coming on site. We have from the University of San Jose Recoletos. We're so happy that we have the teachers of University of San Jose Recoletos from the College of Arts and Sciences. So we have the teachers and also our volunteer consultant, our consultant for our Abtik Paskilat, our Bagong Tiyatyo Kera, daging salamat. Also to the Cebu Technological University, Maine. Are they already here? Wala pa. So they said that they are coming. So from the Pike, the Pet Supply Store. We have from Project Kaleidoscope. We have also from the digital media, digital magazine, Click Cebu. And we have also animal welfare advocate, Pau Pantry Mission, Cebu Technological University. We also have the teachers and students of the Talisay City College. Daghang salamat for joining us. Padulog pa, wala, kulang na tag-chairs. We would run out. We need more chairs because more students are coming. So we also have from the Cebu Normal University. Are you here? So we also have from the University of San Carlos. So did you register online? Wala, no? You registered. You are from the Fine Arts Department. Safad? School of Architecture, Fine Arts and Design. Daghang salamat for joining us. And also, we have the teachers from the St. Louis College of Mandaue. Daghang salamat. And we already talked about future projects with the students that they would be joining this our event to honor our heroes with their talent. Daghang salamat for the input from the teachers of the St. Louis College in Mandaue. And we also have someone who registered from the Sacred Heart School Ateneo de Cebu. And also from, of course, from the Island Rescue Organization. I was told it is the biggest organization of in Cebu. you have nearly 50,000 followers on Facebook. I was told my friend, also an animal, non-human animal welfare advocate, told me that the Island Rescue Organization, with the acronym IRO, is the with the widest network of also advocates. So, and also we have from Southwestern University FINMA. So I would also like to request the list from really those who registered here, because this list is from the online list. So I will also read later this the online participants. So of course, the February is a month of celebration. So February is the celebration of the National Arts Month. And we always celebrate our history through the arts. And we also celebrate the arts. So the National Arts Month theme for this month is Ani ng Sining Bayang Malikain. So it's the harvest of arts and of the people who are the creative people. So of course we also celebrate you already know at Palmgrass de Cebu Heritage Hotel we illustrate and we trace our history and we illustrate what happened to history through the different art forms. So we have songs, as you have seen in our, we have watched our songs at the countdown. So those are songs that tell about the first song, actually, Kuyugi Ko. It already has more than a million views at YouTube. And we're so happy because it tells about our heroes, and then it is being shared by young people. And I saw a very young young kid, like a 5-6 years old or 7-year-old girl, singing that song, making a cover for that song. So we're so happy because it mentions about our heroes. And also, of course, this month, next week, we are celebrating the Lunar New Year, the Year of the Dragon. And of course, you already know, most of you may have known that the dragon is also a mythical creature. It is in the Visayas. So we have this Bakunawa. Do you know the story that the dragon in Bisaya is Bakunawa? And did you know it has the story of the dragon was swallowed the moons and only one moon remained? So, and the Bakunawa is very important for the Babaylanes, our priests, our spiritual leaders in the past. They have a calendar with the Bakunawa. And of course, do you know that Naga, another word for Naga is Bakunawa. A Naga here in Cebu is being said to be a land of mga ungo, diba? So they are the land of witches, or a place of witches. Diba, when you would say, you go to Naga, you just ride a broom, magsakay lang kag silig. Ato ka sa Naga, sakay na lang silig. And then, so of course, according also to our to historians and writers, Naga was the last to be converted in Cebu to Christianity. So we have a book downstairs about the history of Naga, Naga and Minglanilla. So Naga is Bakunawa, and Bakunawa is a very important for the Babaylanes. And Naga in Cebu was the last town to be converted to Christianity. So sige na kung storya diri. So of course, also we have the Hearts Month. It's actually is an official is a government celebration, really, in the National Hearts Month. It's to take care of your heart. You should you should let go of things that should move on from the things that would harm your heart. And then, so it's actually really like it's declared a year ago or to, the National Hearts Month. It's the literal heart to take care of the heart. So our resource person this afternoon is really like has many things to say about hearts. I don't know. The hearts of the dogs. So, and of course, we are celebrating the Valentine's Day. So this is on February 14. And we have also at Palmgrass, we are celebrating the seventh year of our library restaurant. Also, our restaurant named after a character in folklore, Kapihan ni Lumaya. So it is ikapitong tuig sa Kapihan ni Lumaya because Kapihan ni Lumaya opened ahead of the grand opening of Palmgrass the Cebu Heritage Hotel. So do we have it? Wala. So those are our celebration. We also recognize our partners, as we mentioned when we started this, the Tres de Abril Foundation Incorporated, the Central Visayas Association of Museums, the Diandi Heritage Center, the SOAN 2020, the USC Carolinian Political Science Society, and the Island Rescue Organization. And so we also thank the artist who, may we show so this artwork was made by Armand, is created by Armand Dayuha, and it was there was an exhibit here of his artworks, and the title of his exhibit was Pintados. So his depiction of the dog is like a tattooed, it's pintado. The Visayans are usually called pintados, painted people. We were tattooed, but the Spaniards called us painted. We were not painted, we were tattooed. The bravest warriors had the most tattoos. Even the women had tattoos because it is the tattoos were like amulets. So the tattoos were a symbol that you have done a brave deed, or it is also an amulet that for the women it would give them power when they are weaving or when they are healing. Only the women and the gays can be healers in pre-colonial times. So now we have we also thank our online participants. So online participants. We have on-site participants. The director, thank you very much to the director of the Philippine Fiber Development Authority. So he is here with us today. Even if it maybe we would discuss fiber in relation to dogs. So thank you very much for joining us, for being interested in this topic, even if so we have a director, executive regional director, the regional director of the Philippine Fiber Development Authority, Joseph Salas. Daghang salamat for joining us. So we have also online with us the schools division of Taguig City and Pateros. We also have from the Sacred Heart School, Ihas de Jesus. We have from University of San Jose Recoletos. We also have from Cagayan de Oro, Liceo de Cagayan University. We also have from Cebu Normal University. Daghang salamat for joining us. And we also have from Colegio de Santa Ana. We don't know from which part in the Philippines is this. Colegio de Santa Ana. And we have from Ateneo de Davao. We also have our participants online from the University of Santo Tomas. We also have someone from the Boy Scout of the Philippines. Do the Boy Scouts use dogs in camping? No more. Wala dogs in camping for the Boy Scouts of the Philippines. So we also have from the DepEd Pulumulok National High School. Daghang salamat to our friends in Pulumulok for joining us. And also we have from South Daang Hari Elementary School in Taguig City and Pateros DepEd. Also from Maria Asuncion Rodriguez High School, Western Bicutan National High School. So may we have the list of those who registered here? So So we will mention your names later. So daghang salamat to those who made the please share this live event, and daghang salamat to Professor George Emmanuel, historian Professor George Emmanuel Borinaga, for watching. So Cheryl, daghang salamat for watching. Zarlid from Anapindan Integrated School. Mayet from Western Bicuta National High School. Ellen from the Flag Tour Guides. Dudes Milan from the Tour Guides in Cebu. We have Hannah from USJR. Michelangelo, a history enthusiast from Marikina City. Daghang salamat for joining us. Alp Asa, also a tour guide in Cebu. John Riven Kagatin from Upper Bicuta National High School. Ferdy Pagaw, who already bought a copy of your book for you to have, he was here during the Sinulog, but he left his copy that he bought for you to have a dedication for him. And Jeanette Diego, Raul Buzon, a graduate of history from the University of San Carlos, and so many more. So now we are excited to have this event today as we trace the history of our relationship with dogs and what happened to the dogs throughout history until today. And we will have our friends from our partners in this event to give us some reaction later after the event. But we would like to show you our reactors. Una gipa show ang reactors kaysa resource person. So we would like to show you, even if they will not say anything yet, we would like to show you our resource persons this afternoon. Our reactors this afternoon. So we have our reactor from the Island Rescue Organization, and she is the secretary. So please help me welcome Miss Maria Judeline Cabalhac. Show? Wala? Ma-show ni mo ang camera? Yes, so we have Jude, Maria Judeline. Thank you very much for joining us. And also we have from the Iro mo ito pa pronounce ana kay mabisaya man ta Iro nga kanang it's Iro, it the actor is very creative actually. Congratulations for the coming up with this name, Island Rescue Organization, or in short Iro. And the president is Miss Annalyn Aisporo. It's very hard to pronounce. Aisporo. Miss Annalyn, daghang salamat for joining us. And also, we are so thankful to have the youth voice with us and who readily accepted to be a partner in this event. We have from the University of San Carlos, Carlinian Political Science Society, we have Miss Yamani Pabilori. Daghang salamat, Yamani, for joining us. So for this, we would also like you to know that we have upcoming events. Before I would introduce the resource person, gamay na lang yun. Parag, patriling gamay. So we have our events this month. Aside from this event, we will have on February 14 another very exciting event. So we have been discussing the very old word, the first word that means physical intimacy is spelled IOT. It's by the dictionary of Father Mateo Sanchez, a Jesuit priest, in 1611 dictionary. So we will be discussing. We have been discussing in 2021 IOT, the power of women in bed and politics 500 years ago. Last year we discussed IOT ugubat, physical intimacy and war. Because the Visayans launched wage wars because they were prohibited from their practices before the Spaniards came. So the women were very powerful. So you have seen a gadget, the ring. It's not a 299 ring. So it's the very important ring. According to our resource person, the vice president of Siliman University, vice president for academic affairs, our resource person last year, Dr. Earl Jude Cleopi, he said that the woman would ask first, show me your ring. show me the design of your ring. So else, if she doesn't like the design of the ring, there is no communication. love making that would happen. Si Pigafetta described it as communication. Sex was communication in 500 years ago for Pigafetta. So that would be our topic. We will have historian Dr. Rolando Burinaga, a Visayas historian, who would be with us to discuss also the pre-colonial practices of our ancestors. And we will also have a theologian who has a PhD in applied theology, Dr. Levi Lanaria, who is also a professor at the University of San Carlos, to discuss also the religion during the Spanish period until today and the teachings on, the sex practices or on love and sex and marriage. So, and of course, sa nighttime on Valentine's Day, we will have an event, Kasing-Kasing. So, of course, you already know what is Kasing-Kasing. Kasing-Kasing is kabalo naman sa Kasing-Kasing, di ba? Kabalo tatanan kung sa Kasing-Kasing. So it's the Valentine event. There would be harana, there would be games. Describe your ex in one word. And you would win in the ruleta sa Kasing-Kasing. You would win. And then also, find your match. You will find, if you are single, you will find your match. Like you find the other half of your heart in that game, in that event. So, and there are other games in that event. So on February 28, we will have the Kapitong Tuig sa Kapihan ni Lumaya. So we will be having a discussion also on the food as offering to the Diwata, to the Anitos, and we will discuss the healing and ritual food. And we will also have a celebration on that day on the Lamoy. How does a dragon lamoy a moon? There would be an eating contest on that day. So kana humanagyod. So sa March we have a discussion of Yawa, because Yawa was a goddess, a Visayan goddess, and became the term used for the devil. So the demonization of the women and the gays, that would be on March. And we will also have a discussion also of a book talk of the Love and Scandals in Old Cebu. There is a book about the Old Cebu by Gavin Sanson Bagares. We would also be discussing that. So now, naanagyod, ato na introduce ato resource person. So our resource person this afternoon has been with us in about two events in the past, and he is the supervising history researcher and officer in charge of the research, publication, and hierarchy division of the heraldry division of the National Historical Commission of the Philippines. So, and he is also an ex-officio member of the National Commission for Culture and the Arts, National Committee on Historical Research, and he is a board member of the Philippine Historical Association and an associate member of the National Research Council of the Philippines. He graduated with a Master's of Art in History in 2018 and is a candidate for a PhD in history degree at the University of the Philippines, Diliman. And he got his Bachelor of Secondary Education in Social Studies at the Bulacan State University. He founded Project Saysay in 2013 and co-founded the National Youth Forum on Heritage in 2015. He was the former program head of the National Historical Commission of the Philippines Local Historical Committees Network, and he was the head secretariat at the National Quincentennial Committee, the very successful celebration of the 500 years of the victory at Mactan, the 500 years of the circumnavigation of the first first circumnavigation of the world and the 500 years of the introduction of Christianity in the Philippines. So it was very successful because of the leadership of our resource person. And we would like to introduce, it's our pleasure to introduce to you and to please help me welcome the author of the Dogs in Philippine History. Please help me welcome Ian Christopher Alfonso.
Thank you very much, Mama Grifina, for that introduction.
So, daghang salamat to Ian for being with us really on site here. So, of course, you already know that he is the author of this book. This is the puppy edition, but very limited copies. So, it's not yet sold. It's not yet being sold. So, and we have here the book that is also displayed there at the registration table, The Dogs in Philippines. Thank you very much to those who already bought their copies. So we already have actually reservations for the book. And so now as we discuss this this very exciting topic, I would like to ask first, it's not in our prepared questions, but I would like to ask our author, Ian, how did you come up with the idea of writing a book about dogs? What made you become interested to write? It's not in my prepared questions for you. Impromptu question. This is extemporaneous. So what made you write a book about dogs? I would like you to know, to those who are online, that as we go along, we invite you to give your comments and to give your comments and your questions, because you would be giving them kay malubong man na sila, it would be buried in the many comments. So we would be inviting you to put your question at our Facebook Live event. And also, but those on site, to those who have questions, there is an open forum after the reaction from our reactors. But you can also write your questions, because you can easily read them immediately if you write it at the comment section. So now we would like to ask Ian regarding that, what made you write a book about dogs? It's the first, I would say it's a groundbreaking work, because it's the first time that there is a book being written about the history of dogs. Oh yes.
Hello. Basically, because I love dogs. That's the
Hello. Let's check the audio.
Hello, yan.
Yes.
Well, basically, because hopefully naririnig ka maayos. Doon, okay.
Can you have another microphone?
So, I think it's okay already.
It's okay.
So, basically, my love for dogs was my motivation in writing this. And it began, I think, 17 or 16 years ago when I was in college. Sabi ko, bakit kaya sa pag pumasok ka sa mga book sale, ang daming foreign books about dogs, Irish dogs, US dogs, you know? Bakit wala about the Philippines, about aso in the Philippines, no? So, but that was just an idea 17 or 16 years ago, but I started writing it in 2013 when I was already with the National Historical Commission of the Philippines. And I was inspired to create a folder in my desktop in the office, because inevitably, maybe may encounter ka mga sources, images, photographs about dogs. So I told myself, bakit di ko pa simulan kolektahin? Kailan ko pa sisimulan kung di ngayon? And then so happened, our museums, the museums of the NHCP, have portraits of vignettes, no, about Philippine history, the Pinaglabanan, the start of the Katipunan, about Antonio Luna, Melchor Aquino, and then there's this painter na siya yung kinumisyon ng NHCP, and in every painting may mga aso. So I was inspired by those artworks na this is actually the reason or the basis of the title Dogs in Philippine History. Those artworks from the museums of the NHCP na omnipresent ang mga aso sa Philippine history, yet hindi sila nakikita sa written records. So, kaya tumagal siya ng 10 years dahil hahanapin mo talaga. I became a bloodhound, no, sa paghahanap ng mga sources about dogs.
So it's 10 years, it's one decade, 10 years in the making. If it were a dog, it would be how...
Patay na siguro.
So it's really a product of love and hard work, so this book. So of course, the dogs, especially in the barrio. So I grew up in a barrio. For us in the barrio, each house has a dog. We had 10 dogs, more than. And then you don't feel safe. If you are in the bar, you don't feel safe. You don't have a dog in the house. So, but of course, in the cities, you have security guards and you have locks. And so you have locks. So it's really, the dogs are really, you're very important, especially in the bar. I also remember you mentioned that it's in paintings. I remember when we shoot videos, the dogs would really join the video shoot. So we would wait until the dog would go before continuing the shoot. They should have been included so that it would be part of history. So now we would like to ask Ian regarding to this. What are the, in your research about the dogs, please tell us about the most fascinating discoveries about their role and their presence in the history of the Philippines, especially in the Visayas. And what were the specific paw prints that that stand out?
I think maybe I can begin with the PowerPoint I prepared, no? So, well, I was surprised na even though there is a dirt, no, there is dirt of sources about dogs, but mayaman ang ating archaeological records, no? So, and as of today, you know, the earliest documented domesticated dogs in the Philippines were discovered in El Nido, Palawan, in a cave in El Nido, no, Pasimbahan Cave in El Nido, and then in Calyao Cave in Peña Blanca, Cagayan. And if you rounded off those dates, dogs were already here for nearly 4,000 years. Unfortunately, as I was told earlier by my friend, no, from the National Museum, Taj Vitales, an archaeologist, hindi pa natin alam ano itong mga asong ito. But definitely, this the remains of these dogs resemble the remains of these, I don't know, these animals resemble the present day dogs. Pero kung sila ba ay aspin, sila ba ay ibang breed, hindi pa natin alam. At least itong mga to ay sure among archaeologists na remains ng aso. And for the Visayas, so far, the earliest remains ng mga aso na na-discover here in the central Philippines was found in Cebu City. And according to Taj Vitales, chronology ng mga aso na nahukay sa Pilipinas dated 1,400 to 1,600 years ago. May aso na sa Cebu. And this was unearthed in when they had this, I think when they had this archaeological diggings in the Metropolitan Cathedral of Cebu. And then another one is in Tanghai, Negros Oriental, which dated between 1,000 to 1,400 years ago. So it predated, no? The dogs predated the coming of the Spaniards. So, and even in Manila, although in Manila it was quite, I don't know, kapiglid niya yung aso na nahukay sa Cebu. And this is the, according to Taj Vitales, this is the one of the well-researched and well-published remains of dogs in archaeological record, in our history of our, in our prehistoric, you know, prehistory. And this was unearthed in the 1960s by Robert Fox in Santa Ana, Manila. And yung remains ng aso, intact siya, at siya ay kasamang nakalibing ng mga tao. So, and even some of the dogs unearthed in other parts of the country were discovered also with the, you know, with the grave sites of our ancestors. So, according to Noel Amano, one of our archaeologists, mukhang yung mga ancestors natin inililibing talaga sila ng parang tao. So, it only shows na yung foreignhood dati, it could be also because they love this dog, that's why they buried it like human, or malaki ang role ng aso na to sa society at that time, kaya sila binigyan ng marakal na libing. Because in the pre-colonial times, and even up until the 1800s, 19th century, there were the dogs were actually used for hunting. That's why the root word of our Philippine term for hunting, pangangaso, is aso. And even the Visayas, pangangayam, the root word is ayam, also dog, no? So very central ang aso sa buhay ng mga ancestors natin because dogs help our ancestors to search for source of protein. Like baboy damo, usa. So nagbibigay ng ginhawa yung aso. And even in our vocabularies, if you consulted the Mateo Sanchez Vocabulary de la Lengua Bisaya, Berganos Vocabulary de la Lengua Pampanga, Ilocana, Hiligaynon, Bicol, Tagala, there are actually hundreds of vocabularies about dogs. Same with kung gaano tayo, gaano karami yung ating vocabularies associated with gold, with rice, ganun din yung aso. Meaning talagang napakalapit talaga ng ating kultura sa mga aso. And even in our folklore, no? If you are familiar with this epic of Panay, yung Sugidanon, no? Nagsimula yon sa aso. That's why yung unang chapter ng Panay epic na yon ay about the dog, no? Si Tikom Kadlum, no? The first chapter of the epic, no, is Tikom Kadlum. It's a black dog, no, ng isang dato doon sa na isang protagonist ng epic na yon. And even in the Ilocos region, no, the Biag ni Lamang, the epic of Lamang, laging kasama yung aso ni Lamang, and then he also has this rooster sa kanyang shoulder, no, kasama sa journey. And mas pag lumalim ka pa papunta sa Cordillera, even the deities in the Cordillera, lagi may aso sa langit, no? So talagang yung aso ay hindi mo maise-separate talaga sa kultura natin. Until now, no, we pampered dogs to roam around. Hindi sila sanay na nakakulong, nakatali. At yung mga aso, na-accustom na malaya. Kaya nag-iingay sila kapag nakakulong, nakatali, nakabusal, or nakamuzzle. And this was the conflict between the colonizers and the Filipinos, no? Since the Spanish period, the colonizers wanted these dogs destroyed dahil hindi sila magandang nakikita na nakakalat sa paligid. But ito, survivor sila ng colonization. And, well, we develop our laws for dogs, no? The Anti-Rabies Act, the Animal Welfare Act, na nagsasabi na kailangan nakatali yung mga aso, nakakulong, because of course, the threat of rabies, hindi siya fully ma-implement kasi nga because of our culture na gusto natin nakikitang malaya yung mga aso. Pero yun nga, we need to address the fact that nandyan ang rabies. Gusto yun man natin na nakikitang malaya ang aso, but siguro solusyonin, humana tayo ng solusyon sa rabies, which the government, no, set a deadline, but that by 2030, wala nang rabies sa Pilipinas.
So thank you very much for that, Ian. So it's very interesting that because we also discussed about the burial practices last October, we discussed the burial practices. So there were burial sites that there were dogs, as you mentioned. So I'm just curious, I was not able to ask because they were said there were guard dogs. Like there would also be dogs guarding the dead. But it's not in the Philippines, right? It's in other parts of the world. I'm not sure. I was asking because someone was asking me, I was saying there were burial dogs. I mean there were guard dogs, according to one also archaeologist, si Tara Fernandez. And then so but when you said that they are accorded the burial ritual, same as our ancestors, so did they believe that the dogs would also travel from Sulad to Saad? So to the Saad is the equivalent of paradise for our ancestors. The families, the relatives of the dead should do so many rituals, and they need to fulfill the requirements for the spirit of the dead to go to Saad in pre-colonial times. So like they need to have gold with them, they need to bring food with them, and the clothing that they need to bring. So could that have been also, they did also believe that there was a spirit for the dogs?
Well, actually the Cordillerans, no, and even the Tagalogs have this belief na when if happened na meron kayong family member na nagkasakit and biglang gumaling and suddenly namatay yung aso nyo, naniniwala yung mga Tagalog na dinala nung aso yung sakit. Sinacrifice yung sarili niya para guminhawa o gumaling yung tao.
Ah.
So, pag umakyat ka ng Cordillera, this actually isa sa mga pinaka-delicate na discussion, no, yung pag aalay, no, the ritual of offering dogs in the Cordilleras. Ginagawa kadalasan yung pag-aalay ng aso kapag talagang mayroong epidemya o sakit sa pamilya. So naniniwala yung may mga paniniwala sa Cordillera na yung aso na yun kaya niyang dalhin yung sakit. Kaya kailangan siyang ialay. So sa Tagalog, walang pag-aalay, ano? Pero naniniwala sila na tinatangay ng aso yung sakit. And I'm not sure if in the Visayas and Mindanao do have that kind of unwritten belief, no? Na kapag namatay yung aso at gumaling yung may sakit sa family member, dinala nung aso yung sakit. So I think that is the
nearest
religious or cultural belief or folk belief na pwede kong iugnay doon sa spirit dog, no?
So actually in the Visayas that we also discussed these ritual pots that were found, the artifacts of the our babaylanes, and there was also this, you know, the one of our historians, also resource person, Dr. Rolly Bernaga, mentioned about the human sacrifice. Like for example, a person dies, there would be a ritual to exchange spirits. Like there would be someone who would volunteer to give up himself or herself so that the other person would live, and they would offer the human sacrifice. So maybe there would also be, we don't know if there is also that dog sacrifice for those two ill people. So of course the Visayans, also it is mentioned in the book by Ian regarding this ethnographic study by Father Francisco Alsina in 1668 about the dog being very important for the Visayans. Like it's called ayam at the time. They are hunting dogs, and they cherish them more than their children. But you have mentioned already. You mentioned that it is because they provide the meat. So actually, Father Ercina mentioned that the one who has a very good hunting dog is the most fortunate and the wealthiest, because he or she is able to live a very comfortable life because he has meat. It can be exchanged with rice, so he or she would be very comfortable if he has a very good hunting dog. So that's why. So please tell us more about Father Francisco Alsina's study.
Can we go back again to the PowerPoint? No. So yung mga pinakita ko kanina, these are from archaeology, the prehistory. But you may ask, no? Ay, by the way, using the remains of the dog of Santa Ana, Taj Vitales, one of the archaeologists, said na yung mga pre-colonial dogs, especially from Santa Ana, Manila, kasing mukhang ninuno ng mga aspin, no? Because of the build. So at least meron tayong sa sukat man lang ng mga nahukay na aso, mukhang yung mga aspin yung ninuno nila. Kaya pag nakakita kayo ng aspin sa paligid, no, sila yung mga unang aso natin, no, based on archaeology. And then then historically, based on historical records, Visayas was the earliest mention of dog in historical records was in the Visayas, because in 1521, when Pigafetta actually observed animals in the Visayas, and especially in Mazawa, no, he noticed dogs already and cats. So ibig sabihin, bago pa dumating sila Magellan, may aso na sa kapusa sa Pilipinas. And hindi niya masyadong dinitalye ano itsura nila. Possibly dahil napaka-normal lang ng aso, but at least may nakapag-mention historically na there were already dogs in the Visayas, no? And then the next mention of dogs in historical records was in 1544 during the Villalobos expedition, if you're familiar with the expeditions before, after Magellan and before Legazpi, there was this Villalobos expedition na whose aim was to conquer Molucas. And they did not travel to the Visayas actually. You know? I mean, they reached Visayas, but the captain general at that time, Ruy Lopez de Villalobos, resided in Sarangani Islands in Davao Occidental, the present is Davao Occidental, because these islands down south of Davao are closer to Molucas. And that is actually one of my books, ano? The Sarangani Islands. And unfortunately, the mention of dogs in the Villalobos expedition, medyo nakakalungkot. Kinain na mga Kastila yung mga aso sa Sarangani dahil sa gutom. Ano? And then, the next earliest mention of dogs in Philippine historical records was in 1596 when this expedition from Callao, Lima, Peru reaches Camiguin. No? And yun nga, kinain din ang mga Kastila yung aso sa Camiguin out of hunger. Ano? So, tatanungin nyo, sino yung mga kumakain ng aso sa Philippine history? Mga Kastila. Ano? Kastila. Anyway, dahil nga sa gutom. Ano? And then, but the earliest detailed documentation of dogs in Philippine history was made by no other than Father Francisco Ignacio Alsina in 1668. He dedicated a whole chapter, actually, you know, a whole chapter in his book, Historia de las Islas y Indios de Visayas. No? And to dedicate a chapter, no, about dogs, it only means napaka-significant ng role ng aso sa Visayan history and culture. And don't worry, dahil hindi lang aso yung kasama sa chapter na yun, ano, pati pusa. Minention din ni Alsina. And then just to ipasyal ko lang kayo dun sa libro ni Alsina. These are the illustrations found in Alsina's manuscript. And I think Real Biblioteca de Madrid, no, pina-access nila sa atin yung original manuscript ni Alsina. And ito ang itsura ng mga ninuno ng Bisayas, no, ng mga Bisaya, no. Mga tattoo pa rin, may tattoo pa rin hanggang 1668, no? Then ito yung mga bangka sa Bisayas. Colored pala siya. Actually, the one we are often accessing, no, of about Alsina's account was published by UST in the early 2000, black and white, pero dun sa original manuscript pala, colored pala yung mga illustrations ni Alsina, no? And then, ayan, yung sayaw, nakapag-record ng sayaw sa Visayas. And then, pati mga flora and fauna ng Visayas na may elepante pa pala sa Visayas noon. Ano? Ayan, so yung mga paniking malalaki, nakabag. And then, yung mga sea creatures, din drawing din ni Alsina, including Shokoy and Sirena, sea creatures din siya. Ano? Hindi ko alam kung nakakita talaga si Alsina ng Shokoy at Sirena sa Visayas. And then ito naman yung mga iba pang mga four-legged animals found in the Visayas, no? And then ito naman yung particular page na nakadepict yung aso. This is the earliest depiction of a dog in Philippine historical record, no? Ayan ang yung blown up na feature ng aso. Here Alsina used the word ayam for dog, no? And then, based sa itsura ng pagkakadrawing, kamukha siya ng aspin natin. Ano? And then, dahil nga ito yung earliest in-depth documentation of Philippine dog, o pa Philippine dog, dito na natin ngayon pwedeng theoretically ma-reconstruct ano ba itsura ng mga aso ng mga ancestors natin, especially the hunting dogs. According to Father Alsina, yung regard na ibinibigay ng mga Bisaya sa kanilang mga aso ay walang kapantay sa buong mundo. No? He was a foreigner describing Philippine a fragment of Philippine culture, no, about dogs. So, bakit niya nasabi na kakaiba yung mga Pilipino, especially the Bisayans? No? At walang kapantay sa buong mundo yung pagmamahal, the regard, the care of our ancient Visayans for dogs, no? Ito yung sabi ni Alsina. Ay, by the way, before we proceed to dogs, no? Dahil din natin ito madadaanan, ito yung sabi niya sa mga pusa sa Visayas. Kahit daw napakaliit na mga pusa, no? Sa mga cat lovers dito, mas matatapang paraw ang mga pusa ng Visayas kaysa sa pusa sa Spain. No? Mga hunters din ang mga pusa sa Visayas. No? Mas matatapang pa kaysa sa mga pusa ng Visayas, ng Spain. And then, ayan pa, sabi pa, bawat bahay sa Visayas noon ay may pusa. And it is, and it was a prized possession. No? Ibig sabihin, kasi katumbas siya ng ginto, ano, ang mga pusa. Anyway, about dogs, ito sabi ni Alcina, no, and I quote, kilala ang mga Bisaya sa pagmamahal sa aso, no, especially the hunting dogs. Mas higit pa raw yung pagmamahal ng mga Bisaya sa mga aso kaysa sa mga sarili nilang mga anak. So, di ba nangyayari din naman yun, ano, ngayon? Mas gusto pa natin mag-alaga ng aso kaysa magkaanak, ano? So, di ko alam kung totoo yun. So, may pinanggalingan pala yung ating kultura na mas gusto natin yung mag-alaga ng aso. And then, mga babae actually, ang may fondness, mga Bisayan women, ano? Ang may fondness sa aso kaysa sa mga lalaki, ano? At ang sabi ni Alcina, hinahalikan, niyayakap, katabing matulog, mayroon pang sariling kumot ang mga aso sa Visayas. At kung ano-ano daw na excessive care ang binibigay sa mga aso na hindi nila pinapakita sa sarili nilang mga anak. Yun ang sabi ni Alcina. And then yesterday, the National Archives of Mexico launched its Memorica Mexicana. Memorica Mexicana is the digital archives of the National Archives of Mexico. You can Google it, ano? And dahil marami tayong records na naka-archive sa Mexico, especially the Philippines, no? I mean, the Visayas, chinek ko yung mga Philippine records kahapon na naka-upload sa Memorica Mexicana. And then, aside from searching for any Philippine records, sinerch ko rin yung about aso, about dogs. And then there is this entry in the Digital Archives of Mexico na noong palang 1625, I think, no, 1625, I posted it earlier on the Facebook page of Dogs in Philippine History. Merong isang document na parang iskandaloso pala sa Mexico noon na halika ng aso. No, isinumbong ngayon yung taong yun na humalik ng aso sa authorities. So hindi ko alam, kailangan natin basahin yung document, no? Bakit big deal na hindi pwedeng halikan yung aso sa Mexico? Eh at that time, we were under Mexico, ano, from 1565 until they gained independence from Spain in 1821. So how come sa Mexico may ganoong kaso na bawal halikan yung aso, pero gusto ko munang basahin pa yung document, ano yung context? Pero sa Visayas, si Alcina, ikukwento niya ngayon, 1668, na dito, hinahalikan yung mga aso. Ano? Anong meron sa Pilipinas na wala sa Mexico? Ano? Ano yung meron noon? Ano? So, nakaka-relate po ba tayo dun sa sinabi ni Alcina 400 years ago? And then, ito pa. Sinasabi ni Alcina, very firm siya, hindi kumakain ng aso ang mga Bisaya. Okay? At nandidiri sila kapag nakakarinig na may kumakain ng aso. So, na kultura ng mga Bisaya, ano, sa Visayas na huwag kainin ng aso. Ano. And then, sabi pa ni Alcina, pumapatay din ng aso ang mga Bisaya. Pero, sa isang the very reason bakit kailangan patayin ng Bisaya ang aso, kapag yung aso ay masyadong marahas, no? At especially kapag yung aso, yung kanilang hunting dog, eh inaagaw yung hunt o yung game, no? So dahil unruly na yung aso, kailangan siyang patayin. Pero tingnan nyo, paano patayin noon sa sinaunang Visayan society ang aso? Hindi para ditatagain, pupukpukin, parang euthanasia. May pinapakain doon sa aso. So even yung concept ng Visayas ng pagkitil ng buhay ng aso, very humane pa rin, no? It is, I think this is a euthanasia, no? Nilalason siya pero hindi yung lason na ituturok, ano? Kumbaga herb Hindi ko alam ano yung herb na yon na lalasunin yung aso. So maybe dahil kaagaw ng community yung aso na yon sa source of protein, that dog needed to be destroyed, no? So yun yung reason, pero wala nang ibang reason bakit papatay ang Bisaya ng aso except for that, no? And kahit na ang mga Bisaya ay may ganoong kultura pala ng pagpatay, hindi nila pinapatay yung mga inosente at yung mga matanda na at useless. Meron sa useless yung mga hindi capable mag-hunt, no? Pinananatili pa rin lang buhay, even the old ones, no? And ito nga, sabi nga, out of compassion and mercy, no? Pinananatili silang buhay hanggang sa mamatay na yung aso sa katandaan. So, dito yung makikita talaga na the way Alcina described Visayan society, kinumpare niya sa pinanggalingan niyang society, which is Spain. At sa Europe, hindi ganito para sa kanya ang ginagawa sa mga aso. That was why in Alcina remarked, walang kapantay sa buong mundo yung ginagawa ng mga Bisaya at pinapakita sa mga aso. So I think that is the, yes, you know, the gist of the chapter about dogs and cats, yes, in Alcina's historia.
You know? Yes, I remember there was someone who was asking you, will you also be writing a book about cats? So, of course, Father Francisco Alcina was also scandalized that the Visayans were kissing the dogs on the mouth because it's not done in Europe or any other, even in Mexico.
If I may add pa pala, hindi ko lang dito na kabit sa PowerPoint ko, Alcina also mentioned na kahit daw yung mga Bisaya pala noon, pingas ang ilong. Laging common daw yung parang yung ilong mo, parang may kumagat sa ilong mo. Kasi kinakagat ng aso yung mga ilong. So sabi ni Alcina, kahit na nakagat na yung mukha nung Bisaya, ganito pa rin yung regard nila sa mga halimaw na to. Kasi halimaw yung term niya sa mga aso, ano? Beast, yes, ano? Pero ganun pa rin. Tutuloy pa rin yung mga Bisaya sa pagki-care, ano? Sa, kahit na mapaano pa sila, wala sa kanila yon, ano? And then, the Bisayans preferred indigenous dogs than foreign breeds. Alcina mentioned Mastiff and Spanish Bulldogs. But dahil nga daw masyadong yung high maintenance yung mga foreign breeds na yon at hindi sila sanay sa terrain ng Bisayas, hindi rin sila mapakinabangan sa hunting. So it only shows na mas gusto ng mga Bisaya noong unang panahon ang mga aspin versus foreign breeds, no?
Yeah, so they disliked the foreign breed because those were useless in hunting. So, and they were bigger, but
they are hunting dogs in Europe, but hindi hiyang yung kanilang build, yung kanilang energy sa terrain ng Bisayas, no? Kasi yung pag-hunt sa Europe very open, eh dito bundok, no? At pulu-pulu pa yung Bisayas, so walang masyadong open, no? Lahat gubat. At yung aspin ay sanay sumuot sa gubat at sa bundok sa Pilipinas.
Yes. So, Father Alcina also mentioned how they care for the dogs and they would also, we were able to choose which ones would grow to become good hunters.
Yes. Actually, according to Alcina, chine-check ng mga Bisaya yung nipples ng aso kung siya ay pupwedeng maging hunting dog. But I forgot the Bisayan term for that specific vocabulary or term for hunting dog, ano? But the Tagalogs and the Kapampangans called this had this term for hunting dogs, ganid. 'Di ba? Meron tayong Philippine word na ganid, sabihin ano ka, tawag ito, ganid ay ganid ka sa kapangyarihan, 'di ba? Or ganid ka sa greedy, di ba? Greedy. But during those times, the word ganid referred to hunting dogs. Possibly, nag-evolve na yung word dahil hindi na nag-hunt ang mga Tagalog at Kapampangan, yung nagkaroon ng evolution, yung definition ng ganid into something na fear, kung yan ay first dog noong unang panahon, ngayon ang ganid ay sakim na tao, ano? And then in the Visayas, in the Cordilleras pala, ganun din yung way ng pag-identify sa Cordillera ng hunting dog. Sine-check yung areola ng aso. Pero mas naunang na i-record siya sa Visayas ni Alcina. Na mukhang kung sa Cordillera ginagawa yan, sa Visayas, baka sa buong Pilipinas noong unang panahon, ang sine-check talaga nila yung nipples ng aso.
Yeah, so there could have been an explanation for that. So the animal husbandry may know about that. So now we have this, Ian has discussed so many points in history about the dogs especially in the Visayas. So now we would like to ask about the dogs in folklore. So he mentioned one folklore a while ago. And then so, for example, in Cebu or in other parts of the Visayas, there is this Visayan mythical creature called Sigbin. And the book, The Dogs in Philippine History, has also a section on the Sigbin. So please tell us more about this, Ian.
I think pwede sa PowerPoint ulit, check natin. Ano? Ayan. So, ayan. Actually, this is just a theory, ano, na nilagay ko sa book. Yung mga mythological o yung mga folk beliefs kasi natin, possibly yan ay mga subconscious explanation sa mga bagay na hindi kayang i-explain ng mga ninuno natin. One of them, for me, is the phenomenon called Sigbin, the belief of Sigbin of the Visayans up to Bicol. Walang Sigbin sa Tagalog at Kapampangan eh. Dito sa Visayas at hanggang Bicol, kasi Bicolano nanay ko, may Sigbin sila. Hindi ko lang sure sa Mindanao, no? Umabot ang Sigbin hanggang Mindanao. The earliest appearance in historical record of Sigbin was between 1751 to 1754 in the book of Father Juan Jose Delgado, Historia General de Filipinas, I think is the complete title of the book. And then the way we describe Sigbin, a halimaw, di ba? Aswang na nagka-transform into dog, a black dog, and then kapag nakagat ka ng Sigbin, magiging aswang ka, di ba? Pero kapag inanalyze mo, hindi kaya rubbish yung dinidescribe ng mga ancestors natin? Hindi lang ma-explain ng mga ninuno natin bakit nagkakaganon yung mga aso, nagiging ulol, no? Because of the rabies sa kanilang katawan. And take a look at the period, ano, 1751 to 1754. Not even Alcina mentioned something about Sigbin. Ano? Walang Sigbin na na-mention. Kindly correct me sa mga nanonood sa online or sa ating mga kasamahan sa history kung walang mention si Alcina ng Sigbin. But as far as I know, wala siyang description about Sigbin. To the kahit na napaka-extensive ng documentation ni Alcina sa Visayan culture and history, no? Walang Sigbin up until 1751 through Father Delgado, no? So hindi rin sure natin even sa historical records kailan pumasok ang rabies sa Pilipinas. Pero pagdating ng August 16, 1800, ia-announce ng Governor General ng Pilipinas na si Jose Rafael Maria Aguilar na nakapasok na ang rabies sa Pilipinas noong August 16, 1800. And he mentioned in the first sentence of his bandor order na a few years ago, from the issuance of this bando, of this order, may rabies na sa Pilipinas. So, noong 1700s din, pumasok ang rabies sa Pilipinas. Pero a few years ago, according to the Spaniards. And then, I was examining this vocabularios, the dictionaries of our ancestors, and the earliest mention of rabies in any Philippine vocabulary was in Ilocos. In 1792, may rabies na sa Ilocos. So hindi kaya yung period between 1752 and 1800, yun yung period na pumasok na yung rabies sa Pilipinas na naobserbahan ng mga Espanyol. Pero mukhang even before 1792 92, which was the scientific explanation of rabies occurrence in the Philippines, baka yung sigbin ay clue na nababalo na yung mga aso sa Pilipinas because of something in their body, no? At hindi natin sure saan galing yung rabies. Pero sa Amerika, walang rabies bago dumating ang mga Espanyol. Up until 1600s, pumasok ang rabies sa Mexico. Eh, ang Mexico at ang Pilipinas, close ang connection because of the galleon trade. Although, kailangan pa natin kalkalin yung mga galleon records kung on board, may dala-dala silang mga aso from Europe, ay from America, na may rabies. No? Pero ang pinakamalinaw dito, the scientific explanation for rabies occurrence in the Philippines was in 1792. No? And then, ayan, 1 minute. And then dun sa order ni Governor General Rafael Aguilar, medyo nakakalungkot. Dahil walang cure sa rabies at that time, ang tanging mga gawa lang ng gobyerno, which was also a health protocol across the world, across the globe, was to kill all dogs. Inutos ni Governor General na patayin ang mga aso. And meron pa rito ang order na ang isang household kailangan lang mag-own ng isang aso. In excess of one dog, kukunin ng gobyerno para patayin. And that was how depressing to live in 1800 Philippines. Ano, papatayin yung aso mo, no, dahil sa nangyaring yun.
So it would have been, yes, it is devastating for our ancestors who had their livelihood, especially those who were still hunting. Of course, there were still forests at the time, so they needed the dogs for their meat. So it's very bad. it's really an assault against the economic situation of the natives. So, but then the Sigbin, especially in the 1800s, it became, especially in Cebu, for example, in the Visayas, they attributed supernatural powers. They attributed supernatural powers to the dog. Like even our heroes in Cebu, like Leon Quilap. That's why the children that we have workshop with, the school children here in Cebu, wrote this story, si Leon Quilap of Ang Sigbin. Actually, when we were having a workshop with them to make a story for kids, and we asked them, what is the most interesting for you about Leon Quilap? He's the hero of Cebu who led the Battle of 3 de Abril. And they said, the very interesting is the Sigbin. So that's why when they wrote a story, it's si Leon Quilap ug Ang Sigbin. But then it's all cute and all because in the Cebu folklore, when I talk with a descendant also of Gregorio Abellana. Gregorio Abellana is an author about ang kagubot sa Sugbo sa panahon sa mga Katsila. And then his descendant said their grandfather Jovito, also a writer, a son of Gregorio, would say that when they were kids, they would go around to look for a sigbin because they thought that the people who were like the heroes, they have their amulets and the sigbin also would help them. It would transform into, like, it would teleport and it would give you magical power. They could, Leon Quilap would have a sigbin that it's according to the stories. It's not really. it would make him teleport and also, and when the Sigbin, for example, if the owner of the Sigbin dies, it would look for another person whom the Sigbin would be already also a pet or something like the Sigbin would go to another person. So that's the story of the Sigbin, that it's attributed to magical powers also of the heroes in Cebu. So that's why. So and the children also made so many imagination about the Sigbin. They said that the horse of Leon Quilap was also a Sigbin. So that's their stories. So what are other folklore regarding dogs in other parts in the country?
Yes, I think. I'm not sure if in the Visayas, the San Roque belief is prevalent, no? Because sa Luzon, kapag may aso dyan sa paligid, kaya nga, di ba, hindi naman sanay yung mga aso na nakatali. And then, according to Ma'am Agrippina earlier, marami silang aso for security reasons. So, actually, dogs in our community, in the neighborhood, know, no? Kung sino-sino yung mga members ng neighborhood. Hindi naman nila tatahulan yung member na yon ng neighborhood kung hindi siya familiar, no? So, parang nakasanayan na ng aso na maging familiar sa scent ang mga nasa paligid niya. And then kapag hindi familiar yung bisita, like for example, piyesta or birthday mo, daladala mo yung mga kaklase mo, no? Biglang tinahulan ka nung aso. Nasabihin nung may-ari, eh hindi makakagat yan. Pero yung ngipin, nasa binti mo na. No? So parang nagkaroon tayo ng social contract, ating called social contract with dogs, na kapag hindi ka tumakbo, hindi ka habuli ng aso. Sasabihin ng taga doon sa community, bye, dire-diretso ka lang sa paglakad. Hindi yan mga habol, tatahol lang yan. So parang yung ating kultura, nag-adjust sa mga aso instead of dogs adjusting to humans. So ito siguro yung dapat natin konsidera, no? Nahubog ng aso yung ating kultura. Dahil lang gusto nating malaya ang aso sa neighborhood and all for security purposes. Ngayon, nung dumating ngayon yung Christianity, nakita ng mga ancestors natin yung imagery ni San Roque. May aso. So parang yung ating pre-colonial belief, na aking mukha namang pre-colonial belief, na-transfer ngayon sa Christianity because of San Roque's dog. No? And sa mga Tagalog ng Nueva Ecija at Kapampangan sa Pampanga, kapag daw nandiyan na yung aso, babanggitin mo lang yung name na San Roque, pero kagat-kagat mo yung dila mo. No? So, try nyo, no? Tan Roque. Lalayo na ro yung aso. And then, sa Pulilan, Bulacan, and I learned this from my executive director in the Historical Commission, Ma'am Carminda Arevalo, na noon daw bata sila sa Pulilan, Bulacan. Merong incantation na binabanggit kapag nandiyan na yung aso. Sasabihin ng mga taga doon, mahal po naming San Roque, dadaan ng pulube, ang inyo pong aso. Mahal naming San Roque, ang inyo pong aso, dadaan ang pulubi. Pulubi is you. Parang incantation siya. Uulit-ulitin mo yon para lumayo yung aso. So, bakit tayo nakapag-device ng mga ganitong bagay? Instead of removing the root cause, the dogs. Pero mas gusto natin, tayo pa yung nag-adjust sa aso. And it's a thing, it's a good thing about Philippine culture and heritage na talagang hindi natin kayang saktan yung aso, kayang batuhin yung aso, kundi magdasal ka na lang, no? Kasi batuhin mo yung aso.
So, daming salamat, Ian. So, we have so much high regard for the dogs. And as you mentioned, there are so many words that are related to the dogs.
If I interrupt again, Miss Agrippina, I think nakita ko kanina si Miss Mitzi. Anito ba? Si Miss Mitzi, nung launching namin sa Cebu City Library, may nabanggit na folklore sa Cebu sa family nila na similar to warding off dogs, pero harmless. Ano yun, Mitzi? Pwede mo i-share?
Ang microphone.
Si Ma'am Mitzi ay from USJR.
Adiha, dito lang, dito, try mic sa akin.
Sound check. Alright, once again, good afternoon po sa lahat ng nanonood sa amin online and of course to everyone who's here with us at Palmgrass. I would just like to share a brief story about dogs when we were growing up. So, originally po, I am from the town of Dalagete, southern part of the Cebu Island. When we were growing up, of course, we are very fond of running around. But then not all dogs okay sa mga tao, mga batang malilikot. So, whenever there's a dog na parang aggressive sa iyo or parang tinatahulan ka, what we do is we parang ginaganito namin yung hand. Ito yung turo ng parents namin. And then parang you clasp your thumb like this. And then you just have to walk as quietly, and sometimes we can also parang tuon sa tutu. Ay, kana bitong
tutu kana. You spit your saliva.
Oh, yeah.
You spray your saliva. Tutu.
Yes, that's it. Thank you so much for helping me out to translate that one. And so far, this has been transmitted not just sa akin, but sa parents ko. And tinuro din daw po yun ng mga lola nila. Oo. So, throughout, I was asking my parents na, Ma, tinuod yun? Totoo ba na effective yan? Kasi sa amin, we also tried it. Okay naman, but parang growing up, hindi naman siya scientifically, parang oh, ganun ba? It does not make sense to us na younger generations. But then, pag nasa situation ka na, you just have to parang instinctive na ginagawa na lang namin. And then for our parents, they really attest na, we can't also explain, but somehow it works.
Okay.
Oo. So, ang nagturo personally sa mama ko ng style na ganyan is yung lola niya na at that time, kilala sa town nila na isang albularyo.
Yes.
Opo. So,
and tutu is one of the healing practices of the, you know, the albularyo. Thank
yes,
you.
Thank you so much.
Thank you, Ms. Mitzi.
Sige. Thank you very much for introducing Mitzi to Ian. So we have actually, I would tell you about some idioms in Bisaya still being used until now that related to dogs. So there are already comments from our audience online. So we have Ivy from Katbalogan City, Samar, Badulid, Halu, Ian Alfonso, greeting you. Princess from Caloocan City, watching. Also Yasser, and also Rimilin Frak, and Mark Anthony Galan. There is a comment from Rodora Reyes, also a tour guide. Is Rodora here on site? She is watching online. She is a tour guide, and we can relate the love of our dogs because we have two adopted dogs at the home, and they sleep with us inside our house. And the funny thing is, when I'm in deep sleep, my dog would try to get my blanket, and she's going to use it instead. It's really sweet and good feeling when your dog kiss you, and when you wake up in the morning, and our Siberian Husky sleep with us with the aircon, and we kiss our dogs as well. So thank you very much, Dora, for sharing about how about your very loving dogs. And also we have Ellie Sahunya from Northern Mindanao, watching from Lumbia in Northern Mindanao. Michelle also watching from Taguig City and Pateros. Also Feliza. So we would like to share with you, of course, most of you already know these idioms in Bisaya that are related to dogs. So for example, we have an idiom that says, actually, I thank you to award-winning poet Adonis Dorado. He is in Ohio University right now. But he has, I asked him, even it's midnight at their place, I asked him for idiomatic expressions regarding dogs in Bisaya. And he mentioned this. For example, paghut sa buwan. Paghut sa buwan, it's barking at the moon. And it is an idiomatic, it's a Binisaya idiomatic expression illustrating how, like, it's a figure of speech. Means you are nagpaghut ka sa buwan, you are wishing for the impossible. Is there an equivalent in English for that? Wishing for the moon? Wala, no? So ang iro, the dog is
in Tagalog, paghut. Sa Tagalog, suntok sa buwan.
Ah, suntok. So when there is a, may we show those words? So when in the Visayas, we say the dog is barking at the moon or nagpaghut sa buwan, wishing for what is impossible. And then so another word, another Binisaya idiom is nibahag ang ikog. Bahag, which means the tail is between the legs. So it's the coward, because dogs are very brave. Like they hunt wild animals. And then when you when you are a coward, nibahag ang ikog. Nibahag ang ikog. And then when you are violent and you are crazy, ingnon ka og you are called irong buang, mad dog, irong buang. So irong buang. And then and there is another word which is paitoy-itoy. Paitoy is puppy. So paitoy-itoy, like someone who follows without thinking or someone who is submissive to someone, so nagpaitoy-itoy. During courtship, a man magpaitoy-itoy na siya, no? Namay mo na din siya irong buang, the joke. So and then and someone who is being abandoned or pinasagdan or murakag iro nga way tag iya, no? Murag iro nga way tag iya. So someone who is not being taken care of, he or she is called iro nga way tag iya. A dog who has no owner, no? A stray, kung kuan ka na, sige lang kag suri-suroy, walay tumong, murakag walay tag, wala kay tag iya. Iro, murakag iro nga way tag iya. And then, if you are, wakay batasan, if you have a very, really bad attitude, you are called, imong batasan di makaon og iro. So if you are really a bad person for someone, you are said to be, your attitude cannot be eaten by a dog. I was looking for it. I was searching for it online this morning, and di makaon og iro. Someone was saying that a dog eats anything, if and even shit. And then if a dog won't eat you, you are worse. You if the dog can't eat your batasan, you are worse than shit. So imong batasan di makaon og iro. Wa kay batasan di makaon og iro. And then of course also there is another word, tingbitay sa iro. Tingbitay is hanging of the dog. So maybe it's the really a very, very, maybe it's a recent, okay, only the Chinese, according to Alcina, eats the dog, right? The science didn't eat the dog. Then tingbitay sa iro, it's hanging of the dog. So right now, we don't know the origin of the word. We say when payday is already, it's already one day before payday, it's tingbitay. So it's for the, you know, famine or times of kanang tinggutom, no, wala na kay makaon, wa nay sulod, there's nothing left in your pocket. So tingbitay na sa iro. Nganong ibitay ang iro? Ang iro nay kanon, wala na. So it's the really, really the very, you know, lisod na jud kay situation, kay ibitay na ang iro, so tingbitay ang iro.
I think Ma'am Agribina, this was also brought to my attention by Dr. Rolly Morinaga.
Yes.
Among the warais, they also have that concept. Eh. Kapag taggutom na.
Oh, yes.
At kapag may famine, may...
Yes.
I mean, something bad happened to community. Babanggitin nila yung word na yan, yung phrase na yan.
Tingbitay sa iro.
Sabi ko, ba't nyo lang po sinabi ngayon lang? Sana naihabol ko sa libro. if you are familiar with Bob Cooty, the historian Bob Cooty.
Yes, yes. I read him.
He has this book entitled Hang the Dogs.
Yes.
No. So the book is about the Balanghiga massacre. Mm-hmm. And according to Dr. Borinaga, that title was inspired by that waray or the Bisayan idiom na
tingbitay sa iro. So I thank once again Adonis Dorado for giving me this, and I was also asking him because actually, there is this, di ba, we have this very popular ride, which is habal-habal. But I was asking him because in one of our discussions, habal-habal, you know what is habal-habal? Habal mo say habal? So it is the way how animals have copulate or have sex, right? So I was asking him, is habal-habal really, does it refer to dogs? And he said, it's iniro. So and then the ride, that the motorcycle ride where everyone is there, so many passengers are there in the motorcycle, it's called habal-habal. It's also like habal. It's a the way how dogs and other animals have sex. And then did you know that in the Boxer Codex, it's a 16th century book about the how Europeans describe the way of life in the of the Visayans and other parts of our archipelago. They mentioned, I was asking Ian a while ago, but he said I can't comment about it. The women, according to this European account, that the women of the Visayas in before the Spaniards came, like this particular possession in sex. It's dog style. Because of the gadgets, so actually, so the women, as I told you, we will be discussing this more in detail on February 14, that they wanted the ring. If the man doesn't have a ring, like the ring, the penis ring with the pin, according to the Boxer Codex, it says that the penis ring and the pin would make them be joined. The man and the woman would be joined like dogs from night until morning, and the women find it very delectable. And if he didn't like the ring, wala, dili pwede. So dog style. Then we had a discussion about that with the someone who studied the indigenous peoples, and they said that actually the indigenous peoples also imitated the possessions that the animal that they see in the forest. So but Ian wouldn't comment anything about that, and we will have more discussions because it's still dog style. So would they have observed it and tried it because of how dogs
That's why, Mama Gripina, I'm inviting you to write a chapter in the upcoming Volume 2 of Dogs in Philippine History.
So now we would leave the dog style. And so we would go now to I would like to ask Ian, as a historian, so what were his challenges? Or what do historians encounter? What challenges do historians face when uncovering the stories of the dogs in history, and why are they underrepresented in narratives? Like, for example, what was the reaction of the natives when there was a policy to kill the dogs? It's not usually known, so we just knew about that now.
I think we need to inspire our fellow young historians to unearth more about this bando of Governor General Rafael Maria Aguilar, no? If what was the impact of this bando in the Visayas? But in Luzon, napakatindi ng impact nito. Because in Intramuros, if you've already been to Intramuros, there's this ayuntamiento, yung building na katabi ng Manila Cathedral na ngayon na Bureau of the Treasury. Mayroon noon pabuya, no? May pabuya noon ang governor ng Manila. That during that time, Manila was a province also, no? It is now composed of the province of Rizal and Metro Manila except Valenzuela. Valenzuela then was part of Bulacan, okay? So, ngayon ang utos noon, magdala kayo ng patay na aso sa ayuntamiento, sa Cabildo, the Council of Manila, and the Cabildo would pay you for that, a bounty for a dog, ano? So may mga ganun na policies. So parang napaka-random pumatay noon ng aso, no? But thank you to Dr. Rose Costello, who just finished her dissertation or her PhD in Universidad Complutense de Madrid in 2021, and her dissertation is about the 19th century public works in the Philippines, especially in Manila. And among the policies implemented by the Spaniards was to kill dogs, no? To destroy dogs, no? Especially the stray dogs. Kasi parang hindi na raw kaaya-ayang tingnan sa isang syudad tulad ng Maynila. Ito sa global city at that time. Global city pa rin ba siya ngayon, ano? It's a global city, you know? Na may mga asong pakalat-kalat sa Maynila, and they had to be removed, no? From the sight of the public. So, nakakita si Dr. Costello sa Archivo Historico Nacional. This is the archives in Madrid where most of our public decrees during the Spanish period until the 19th, during the 19th century are deposited. So meron palang utos noon, meron palang isang pangyayari noong 1875 na hindi natin alam na nangyari, na may apat na mayor ang Maynila. The mayor of Quiapo, Sampaloc, I forgot the two others, just read the book. Ano? So may mayor noon ng Quiapo, Sampaloc. Ano? Ah, napakagulo. Parang ang weird ng setup ng local government noon ng Maynila. Na even Quiapo and Sampaloc ay may sariling mayor. Ano? Ngayon, isa lang ang mayor nila. Anyway, there were these four gobernadorcillos, equivalent now to the present day municipal mayor, nagprotesta sa governor ng Manila. Sabi nila, i-excuse nyo kami dyan sa pagpatay sa mga aso. Ibigay nyo nilang sa Guardia Civil yung pagpatay sa aso. So, kumbaga parang may naninindigan for the dogs. Kasi parang hindi maatim ng mga Pilipino na nakikita nilang pinapatay yung mga aso. And thanks for this four brave gobernadorcillos of Manila. Pero unfortunately, nawala na sila sa history. Hindi natin alam kung sino ang pamilya nila, ano nangyari sa kanila after that. Pinapatay ba sila? Dahil kumunta sila sa isang policy ng mga Espanyol. And during that time, kapanahunan nila sila Rizal, sila Del Pilar, yung mga bayani ng propaganda movement. No? Parang nakapagtakabat sila Rizal, walang mention about this dog policy. No? Hindi ko sure kung iba lang talaga ang interest nila Rizal, pero wag natin sisihin. Baka sila Rizal hindi nagsalita about dog policies. Ano? So, ayun. And then, may pagkakataon pa na sobrang dami na raw ng napapatay na aso. Hindi mabilang yung mga napatay na aso sa Maynila. So, dinesignate noong 1870s din ang Bagumbayan, which is now the Rizal Park Luneta, as the grave site sa mga asong pinatay noong Spanish period. Yung beach from Bagumbayan to Tondo, which is now the Rojas Boulevard, yun ang naging huling hukay, no? Dinadump doon yung mga patay na aso. Kung bakit doon dinadump, wala kasing tao noon sa Luneta. Kasi sinadya talagang sirain yung dati siyang town, sinira ng mga Espanyol, even the church, para malinis. Kasi obstruct. No-obstruct niya yung view ng Intramuros in case na may impeding na pag-atake from Manila Bay. Kailangan malinis yung vista ng Intramuros. So dahil wala naman tao doon sa Luneta, doon nililibing yung mga pinapatay na aso. At tingnan nyo, umabot yan hanggang 1870s. Nangyayari yung pagpatay. And if you may ask, paano pinapatay yung mga aso noon, medyo nakaka-depress yung ating usapan. Ano? Nilalason yung mga aso. No? Nilalason. Hindi ko lang sure kung noong 1800 na pinatupad ni Governor General Rafael Maria de Aguilar yung pagpatay sa mga aso, ano yung method ng pagpatay. But in the 1860s, it was also implemented in Madrid na nilalason yung aso. Dito ba sa Visayas, tanong ko lang po, meron ba kayong belief na kahit kaunting pinch lang ng betsin, malalason yung aso? Diba?
Heard of it. Yes.
Diba? Tinanong ko yung mga kaibigan kong veterinaryo, totoo ba yun? Hindi rin nila ma-explain, pero mukhang hindi totoo kasi lahat naman ang kinakain ng mga alaga natin, table food, mayroon ding betsin, sinangag, di ba? Pansit. So, wala naman ako nabalita ang namatay sa sinigang na aso sa Pilipinas. And then, parang sa Pilipinas siya isolated na paniniwala. No? Pero, mukhang yung betsin thing, like sigbin, ay cultural memory natin ng isang pangyayari sa past na hindi natin malimutan. Because the way the Spaniards implemented the dog killings in the 19th century, mayroon silang ipinapahid na crystalline substance na sa karne, and then yung karne na yon iiit siya, itatapon sa kalsada. Overnight, gagawin yun ng mga authorities, pag madaling araw, kukolektahin na yung mga patay na aso. So mukhang nagkaroon ng cultural trauma yung mga Pilipino na kapag nakakita ng betsin, huwag nyong ilayo nyo sa aso yan. Because of that crystalline substance called strychnine. No? Strychnina ang tawag ng mga Espanyol doon. Pampatay sa Europe ang tawag doon dog killer, no? Yung strychnine. Ngayon, ito nakakatawa, bilog ang mundo. Nadiskubre ng mga Europeans yung substance na yon noong 19th century na pampatay ng aso because again, during that time, It was a protocol across the globe na patayin yung aso kapag may rabies outbreak. Ngayon, na-discover ngayon yung strange 9 noong 19th century as dog killer. No? Magugulat kayo, galing pala sa summer yung substance na yun. Bilog ang mundo, na-discover yung pampatay ng aso na yun sa summer. So, nasa libro yun. Kasi merong isang Father Camel something. I forgot the Jesuit lay brother na na-assign sa summer na nagpadala ng isang specimen ng halaman ng isagod ang tawag. Isagod. Panglason siya. Ginagamit siya sa pana noon ng mga Bisaya panglaban sa kalaban. So possibly yung mga poisoned arrows noon galing doon. Isagod ang tawag ng mga Bisaya, no, ng mga taga-Samar doon. Nagpadala kayo ng specimen sa Europe noong 1700s, noong I think 1790s. Para aralin ng mga botanist yung halaman na yon from Visayas. And then, yun pala yung pagagalingan ngayon ng Strange 9 pagdating ng 19th century. Pero, yung reason bakit ipinadala ng isang Jesuit lay brother from Visayas sa Europe yung halaman na yon para alamin yung medicinal ano niya, components. Pero, from that halaman, na-invento ng mga Europeans yung Strange 9, pampatay ng aso, na nakarating pa sa Pilipinas. At ang supplier ng Strange 9 sa Pilipinas, nakakagulat kung sino. Jacopo Zobel de Sangronis, ano? Isa sa mga ninuno ng mga ng Ayala. Ano? Kasi may butika siya sa Maynila at siya yung nanalo sa bid ng Spanish government to produce that dog killing substance na parang betchino tawas.
Okay. Daghang salamat, Ian. So, for those online who have so many questions, so you would read your questions after the reaction from our reactors in a few minutes. Like, we have two more questions for Ian. Itugno mo? Tugno. And I remember that I didn't mention one of the idiomatic expressions, bugnaw pa sa simud sa iro. Bugnaw pa sa simud sa iro. Do you know what that means? Ano man? Ano meaning sa bugnaw ang simud? Ha? If it's cold. Oh, frigid ko no. According to Adonis, it's frigid. Like, the relationship is frigid. Bugnaw pa sa simud sa iro. It's colder than the snout of the dog. And then, when we were also in college, like, if someone cannot express his or her okay, his feelings, we would also say bugno BS, bugno og simud. So bugno og simud, bugno pa sa simud sa iro. It's cold in the relationship. Bugno, ing anak ka bugno ang simud sa iro. So now that there, our next question for our book author is regarding the street dogs, how did they become miserable after, of course, they were killed by this, there were killings and what else?
I think we need to be clarified, ano? We need to clarify that na kapag nakakita kayo ng aso sa labas, hindi yan automatic stray dog kasi makamamaya homeless, makamamaya mga aso lang yan na talagang casually lumalabas ng bahay na nagigipagmingle sa mga aso sa paligid, ano?
So native dogs
kasi inilalahan kasi na stray dog sila, eh may mga aso na gaya nga ng nabanggit ko kanina, yung ating kultura mahilig sa, I mean, na pamper natin yung mga asong pag-alagala sa paligid, yung buong community ay kanilang world, no? Before the Spaniards came, well, we can theorize na very malawak yung ginagalawan ng mga aso, no? Kasi yung mga bahay noon ay nasa tabing ilog, no? Nasa bodies of water, and then behind sa mga bahay na yan, may napakalawak na palayan or something. So malaya yung aso makagalaw. When the Spaniards arrived, they implemented reduction. Ito yung iniipon mo yung community, yung mga population, papunta sa poblasyon, kung saan maririnig pa ng tao yung tunog ng kampana. Kaya nga mayroong concept, may idiomatic expression na bajo de los campanas. Ibig sabihin, yung kapag naririnig mo pa yung kampana, under ka pa ng bayan na yon, no? So the more na malapit ka sa pueblo o sa poblasyon, the more na sabihin natin sibilisado ka, ano? So kasi kumbaga tinanggap mo yung colonization, yung Spanish authority. Kaya nagdikit-dikit na yung mga bahay. Ngayon, ang open space na lang ngayon ng mga aso compared to the malawak na pugirin, malawak na parang, no? Ngayon, ang open space na lang ngayon ng mga aso during the colonial period, kalye in the plaza. Kaya nga nabuo yung term nating asong kalye. Kalye is a Spanish word, di ba? For road. So nagkaroon ng asong kalye, askal. Kasi nga naman, nasa kalsada na sila. Eh wala namang ibang space na pwede silang galawan kundi yung kalsada na lang. At dumating sa point na kahit naman sa Visayas, may naririnig pa po ba kayo nangangaso ngayon sa Visayas? Except for mayayaman na naging ano na lang siya, leisure, ano? Pero yung pangangaso na, yung
yes,
hunting,
are still,
yung
in,
hunting talaga na kukuha yes, ng karne.
Yes, ah, okay. Like in Bohol, yes. I have heard about, they are still using the dogs, the farmers, okay. In the really the mountain areas.
Oh, good thing to know na meron pa pala, no? Pero yung way of life siya ng ordinary Bisaya,
it's just like a
Bicolano,
special treat
okay,
for them.
Oo, tama, or Tagalog, Kapampangan, wala na. Yung usual isang pamilya o mga anak punta tayo sa bukid. Bukid, mangangaso tayo. Ano? So wala nang ganoon during that compared to this during the pre-colonial times or early Spanish period. So nawala ngayon yung na-diminish ngayon yung role ng aso as hunting hanggang sa dumami na silang dumami. Hanggang sa dumating sa point na naging nuisance sa paningin natin, no? And dumating pa yung point na nagkaroon ng rabies, lumayo tayo sa mga aso sa kalye, di ba? At yung mga aso na lang na inaalagaan natin sa loob ng bahay, ang nakakatanggap ng pagka-pamper, no? Dumating pa yung point na na-expose tayo sa mga foreign breeds, mas gusto natin yung mga foreign breeds versus sa mga katutubong aso natin kasi nga nawala na yung purpose nung mga aso natin, which is hunting. Naging yung pag-aalaga ngayon, nag-shift na to what we now call foreign food. No, gusto lang natin silang nasa bahay. Yung mga hunting dogs like mastiff, hindi na sila nag-hunt. Doon na sila nag-hunt na lang ng ipis sa kabuteke, sa bahay, di ba? So, parang kung nag-shift na yung ating regard. At partly, to be blamed, ay tayo. Kung bakit naging miserable yung Aspin. Maybe, kung magkaroon tayo ng consciousness na napaka-great na mga aso natin, especially the Aspin, baka maibalik natin yung dating regard. And I always say this, no? Since day one of this dog book, no? Basahin natin si Alsina at magugulat tayo na mas gusto ng kulturang Pilipino, especially the Visayans, ang asong Pinoy, no?
Yes. And yes, it's really Father Francisco Alsina stressed how the Visayans dislike the foreign breed. So you mentioned already
yes,
that
but
we have learned.
Yes, pero not at the expense of the foreign breeds na inaalagaan natin. Ano? Hindi ko sinasabing itakwil natin yung mga Shih Tzu. Ano? I have a Shih Tzu too. Ano? Kumbaga parang deserve din naman ng mga Aspin yung pagmamahal. No? The loving Filipino home. So, kumbaga bakit naging accustomed tayo sa pag-aalaga ng iba't ibang breed at naging paradise ang Pilipinas even to the winter dogs like huskies ano sa Siberian dogs. It's because of our foundation na nagsimula sa Aspin, no? Kumbaga naka-embed na sa atin for nearly 4,000 years na ang Pilipino ay culturally mapagmahal sa aso. So nakinabang pati yung mga ibang breeds pero sana dumating naman yung point na yung sarili naman nating aso ang pakitaan natin ng pagmamahal, no?
Yes, especially it's the love month. we are discussing this and during the love month. So it's kind of coincidental. So my last question for Ian, and then we will entertain the questions from the audience later and also online after the reaction from our reactors. So what is dog breed dispersal and why is the Philippines a catalyst in the dog breed dispersal?
Yes, actually, ito yung naobserbahan ko sa mga records na because of the galleon trade, no? Hindi po pwedeng makarating ng Amerika ang produkto ng Asia, especially China, nang hindi ibinabagsak sa Pilipinas, especially Manila Bay, no? Hindi rin po pwedeng makarating ang produkto ng Amerika or ng Europe from Atlantic crossing to the Americas sa Asia nang hindi ibinabagsak sa Pilipinas. So possibly even dogs, no, nakarating because of this trade. Noong 19th century, noong 1800s, no, itinitrace ng mga Latin Americans yung isang Chinese dog sa Maynila. Di ba, sino nakaparoon dito ng Coco? Coco. Di Disney Pixar, ano, Coco. Di ba nandun si Dante? Yung Sulu dog, di ba? Yun ay hairless dog ng Latin America. Merong tatlong breed ng Amerika ng hairless dog, no? Pero dumating sa point na mas gusto, mas pinapatronize ng mga Latin Americans yung isang hairless dog galing China. Na ang sabi nung early 1800s, galing daw yun ng Maynila. Hindi naman katutubo sa Maynila. Wala naman tayong ganong katutubong aso na baka mamaya aspin na may galis. Ano? Ayun yun. Naging hairless. Pero no, very definite yung mga Latin Americans. Maliit siyang aso na ang tawag nila ay pero chino. Pero in Spanish is dog. Chino is Chinese. Pero chino. Ibig sabihin, it's a Chinese dog. Ngayon, chinek ko, ano ba yung Chinese dog na hairless? Yung pala, yung Chinese crescent dog. Isa siyang maliit na aso na hairless. So, naging patok sa mga Latin Americans. At ngayon, sasabihin ng mga Latin Americans, yan ay galing Maynila. Not even from China, but in Manila. Maaring dala-dala sila rito ng mga Chinese sa Maynila at napuslit papuntang Amerika at nakilala ng mga Latin Americans. Ngayon, noong early 1700s naman, during the time na nag-open ng India ng trade network sa Maynila kasi gusto rin nilang makakuha ng prize possession ng galleon, which was the silver from the gold mines of Peru, no? Yung kasi yung dahilan bakit nakuha ng Espanyol ang pinakamalaking market sa mundo noon, China, no? Kasi gustong-gusto ng mga Chinese yung silver from Peru. Ngayon pati India gusto rin nilang makakuha ng silver from Peru, kaya nagkaroon ngayon ng connection between Manila and India. Ngayon, anong connection sa aso? There was this Spanish ship from Manila na nagland sa Madras, no? I forgot the present name of Madras, at Chennai in India, no? Na may dalang tatlong malalaking aso na hindi na-explain ng isang Italian chronicler. Ano tong tatlong malalaking aso from Manila? No, bloodhounds daw to from Manila. Eh, hindi naman ganun kalalaki yung mga aspin natin para masabing bloodhounds. And then the way that Italian described these dogs, umapatay ng tao kapag pinakawalan mo. Kaya laging naka-chain, no? So fierce tong asong ito. At merong isang general, during that time, merong Mughal Empire sa India, no? Ito yung sila yung nagpatayo ng Taj Mahal, no? Mga Mughal, no? Mughal Empire, Mughal Empire, no? Ngayon, merong isang general na ang pangalan si Daud Khan, na balita ang may daladalang tatlong malaking asong fierce itong Spanish ship na to. Gustong-gustong makuha nung general na yon yung mga aso. Hanggang sa kinausap ngayon ng British governor ng Madras, yung kapitan na Espanyol, surrender mo na lang yung aso mo kung di magkakagulo tayo. Kasi napaka masyado raw kilabot, no? I mean, kilalang mainitin ang ulo nung general na yon. Binigay naman ng Espanyol yung dalawang malalaking aso na yon. And then meron pang pangatlong aso gusto rin niya makuha. So ang ginawa ngayon nung kapitan, sige, bigay ko na rin sa inyo. At ang kapalit, trade network for Manila, no? At nagpapasalamat ngayon yung general, si General Daud Khan kay Kapitan Manuel yung pangalan niya. At bago siya pabalik ng Maynila, meron pang mga ano, pinasalubungan siya ng kung ano-anong mga gold, ganyan. And then meron pa siyang mga entourage from India papuntang Maynila. So ito ang kwento ng galleon trade. Pero may mga aspects siya na may kinilaman sa aso. So, pagdating ng 19th century, magugulat tayo na meron na palang Dalmatians sa Maynila, ay sa Pilipinas. And the earliest recorded Pilipino na nag-aalaga ng Dalmatian sa Pilipinas was no other than Marcelo H. Del Pilar. Ano? Wala nang iba. So far, the earliest, I'm not saying he was the first, but the earliest recorded in the 1880s may Dalmatian na sa Pilipinas. And then there was this German photographer and ethnographer named Alexander Schadenberg. Nag-picture-picture, bago-bago pa lang ang camera noon eh, noong 1880s. Nag-ikot siya sa Luzon. And then, one of his photographs of Ilocos, may isang pamilyang ilustrado, elite family. Kasama dun sa family picture, isang aso. Hindi naman aspin. Australian Terrier in the 1880s. No? And then in the 1840s, during that time na nag-open ang Pilipinas sa world trade, because the galleon trade ended in 1815. The monopoly of the Spaniards, no, in 1815 was ended. And then in 1837, inopen ng Pilipinas sa buong mundo ang kanyang sarili. Kahit sino pwede nang pumasok sa Pilipinas. And among them were the British. Nagulat ang mga British nung pagdating nila sa Maynila. May mga Maltese sa Maynila. Maltese dogs. Sino may Maltese dito? May Maltese dogs. Eh sa Britain, pa-extinct na yung Maltese. At ang kilala na lang nag-aalaga ng Maltese noon sa Europe ay ang nanay ni Queen Victoria. Kaya doon sa aking libro, dinlagay ko doon yung portrait nung huling Maltese daw, no, sa napag-aari nung nanay ni Queen Victoria. Pagdating sa Maynila, ang dami palang Maltese. So hindi natin alam saan galing yung Maltese na yun na nasa Pilipinas. At nakilala ang Maynila noon as the origin of this breed called Manila dog. And then ang tawag pa ng mga Pilipino dun sa Manila dog na yon, Sampaguita, kasi maputi, no? So ang number one breeder nung Maltese na yon, mga British, kasi nga sa kanilang pinanggalingang bayan sa Britain, royal dog siya. Eh dito sa Pilipinas, pwede kang bumili ng kahit ilang gusto mong Maltese, di ba? So, paano nangyari na sa atin na yung mga breed na yan? And then pagdating ng American period, magkakaroon ng first dog show, no? Dog show. 1910 sa Luneta. Tinawag nila, sinong gusto mag-participate sa dog show sa Luneta? 1910, nagulat yung mga Amerikano. Ang dami na palang breed sa Pilipinas noong 1910. Saan galing yung mga yon? Hindi natin alam. And then yung sikat na photograph ni Rizal na execution niya, nakita niyo na may execution photo ni Rizal sa Luneta? May aso doon. Hindi yun aspin para sa akin. Ano. Possibly, it could be a Jack Russell Terrier or an Andalusian Terrier ng mga Espanyol. No? So, hindi na pala bago itong mga breeds na to. And then, dumating pa yung mga Amerikano, 1898, may mga Chow Chow na sa Maynila. At yung mga Chow Chow na kagulat, stray dogs sa Maynila. Ano? Eh ngayon, napakamahal ng mga Chow Chow, di ba? Di ba? Pero na-appraise yung value ng Chow Chow because of the Americans, especially George Dewey, the conqueror of Manila. Kasi bago niya sakupin ang Maynila noong 1898, sa Hong Kong, nakapulot siya ng Chow Chow sa isang tulay sa Hong Kong at naging mascot ng mga Amerikano. Nagulat yung mga Amerikano, saan ang ganda-ganda naman ng teddy bear na aso na yan? So umuwi siya ngayon sa Amerika, nagka-hero's welcome. Kasama niya yung Chow Chow. Nagkaroon ng craze sa Amerika about Chow Chow dahil never pa raw nakakita ang mga Amerikano ng Chow Chow. So ngayon sa Maynila, kung ano-ano, binili nila yung mga Chow Chow. Hanggang sa nag-increase, tumaas yung value ng Chow Chow. Hanggang ngayon, mahal pa rin ang Chow Chow. Ano? Yun lang yung ano, ma, makikita ko, na may kukwento ko about the breeds.
So daghang salamat to Ian for sharing with us this precious information about the history of dogs in our country. So now we would read the questions. There are so many questions later after the reaction from our reactors, from our partner organizations in this event. So first, we would like to have the reaction from the secretary of the Island Rescue Organization, Jude Kabalhak. So please go to the microphone to give your reaction to the discussion this afternoon. And we would like you to know that we have trivia quiz with exciting prizes in a few minutes after the open forum. So make sure that you remembered what we discussed so that you will be able to win exciting prizes. So we have Jude.
Sound check. Hi, hello everyone. Good afternoon. Thank you so much for this opportunity to be able to participate with this deep conversation with a prolific writer, historian Sir Ayan. And with that discussion earlier, I have gained a lot of learnings and knowledge, especially new knowledge, especially with the history of the dogs in the Philippines, especially in Visayas. And those things are new to me, actually. And as someone who works in animal welfare, it is very important, I guess, to be able to know the history of those who are we working for. And IRO is sheltering more than 100 of rescued Aspins. 99% of our rescues are most of it are Aspins. And it is very helpful for me to be able to participate with the conversation because I have gained a lot of knowledge. And I am originally from Samar, and it is very helpful for me to matutunan yung mga idioms in the Visayas, especially. I have encountered those, but then we did not use those in most cases. And with the dogs in the Philippine history, I just want to give an comment about it because we know we were taught about the history in Yumas, we were colonized. We just know that we were colonized. We just know that the execution of Rizal, but behind those, we don't know that those nga mayroon mga dogs behind that events. And it is very special for this book to be able to give the point of view of the animals. And most people doesn't know that. We were just taught about the history, the events that happened in the past, but we didn't know that there were dogs who were also part of that past. And it is very homage for them, for the dogs to be specified of what are their roles, especially with the culture of the Philippines. And over the years, there are really difference already with the roles they have right now. So kung sa past they were used for as a hunting partner. So right now it is very good also of the changes because most of our dogs are home dogs already and we do not use them as a watchdog of our house or someone's security, but we have them because we consider them as someone who belongs to our family already. And I guess this is something very important conversation, and I am really glad to be able to learn a lot of things and to continue working for our dogs, especially the Aspin, for their welfare. That's all from me. Thank you.
Dahan salamat. Dahan salamat, Jude. So we are so happy. Thank you for your insights, and we thank you for your comment, and that we thank also that this conversation has helped you as someone who works for the dog, cats, and the animal welfare in Cebu. Thanks, salamat. So next, we would like to have the voice from the youth. So we have our partner from the University of San Carlos, Carolinian Political Science Society, Yamani Pabilore.
Hello. Okay, thank you. Good afternoon, everyone. Good afternoon, Sir Ian. Before I start, I would like to thank Palmgrass, the Cebu Heritage Hotel, for inviting the Carolinian Political Science Society again to their forum. As a person who is both a dog lover and who has 6 dogs back in our hometown and a history buff, this is a privilege to talk about something you love, a feeling that I'm sure that our speaker is well acquainted of. It is quite interesting to learn about our history, specifically Visayan culture through Man's Best Friend, because for one, we are used to learn about history by human beings, but to have one about our canine friends is nothing short of amazing. I would like to present a few points I realized while listening through the whole forum. First, I would like to commend Sir Ian for discussing both the positive in the form of our relationship with our dogs as hunting companions and even guards, and the negative side of things, which is rabies. It presents a balance in things, as not all good things can remain as such, no matter how much we love and we care for it. There's always a catch for everything, a sort of yin and yang in this situation. But anyways, thank God for rabies shots for that. However, it is saddening that poisoning dogs are still used as a tactic today. From where I'm from, which is Camiguin, which was said earlier, throwing raw meat laced with a certain crystalline substance to alleviate rabies breakout and vehicular accidents due to stray dogs are still done in our island. But I do hope that our government would make policies to combat these issues that do not require the death of our dogs. Second, I appreciate the call out on Filipinos giving a bigger regard to hybrid dogs. Aspens deserve the same amount of love we give to other dog breeds. Their mixed heritage grants them unique personalities, adaptable temperaments, and boundless affection. They might not have fancy pedigrees or predictable appearances, but their hearts beat just as fiercely, craving companionship, playtime, and belly rubs. Like their pedigreed counterparts, Aspens bring immense joy and loyalty into our lives, offering an unconditional love and goofy antics. They deserve comfortable beds, healthy meals, and engaging walks just as much as any other dog. May everyone realize this and open their hearts to the boundless love an Aspen can give, and to remember that companionship often comes in unexpected packages. Lastly, I would like to put emphasis on this point because it is one that I saw as one of the many alike principles dogs have, the same with man. And it is the fact that dogs will always bark out when being caged in. It might be typical for a political science student to see, anything about a political aspect on everything, but it struck me when Sir Ian mentioned that it's the same with us as people who are part of a system that favors those on top. Yeah, those on top to call, or in this context, bark out for justice when we are maltreated and our rights are being abused. To me, it presented a manifestation of resistance against the people who control our society. Truly, dogs are man's best friend in every sense of the word, as they go through the same thing despite our drastic differences. Once again, thank you for this opportunity and thank you, Sir Ian, for your work.
Thank you very much, Yamani, for the very beautiful and political insights regarding our discussion. So thank you for really representing the Carolinian Political Science Society and talking about barking out justice. Very well said. Thank you very much. So, and last but not the least, we would like to call the president of the Island Rescue Organization for her reaction, Miss Annaline Aisporo.
Good afternoon, everyone. But first of all, thank you for inviting IRO or IRO or Island Rescue Organization. I learned a lot today about IAM, which is first time I heard that name, IAM, because ang alam lang natin is Bantay, IRO, IDO, Aspin, Askal. But for me, I learned this from my great-grandfather, my grandfather, and my father. Regarding the Spanish era about the dogs, and it's so sad, no, that my ancestor pala is very cruel to animals. Kaya nga siguro, ngayon, naging animal advocate ako. So, during the time of Spaniard, sa pagkakaalam ko regarding Aspin, they are called Aguinaldo dogs. Is it true, sir? They are called Aguinaldo dog because the Aspin are a very good hunter and Aguinaldo is really a hunter.
So all daw na mga dogs during the Aguinaldo time ay tawag is Aguinaldo dogs. So yun ang one of the history nga nalaman ko sa mga Spanish ko na ano, sa mga Spaniard ko na mga relatives. But anyway, having a pet is really very important, no? It's a lifetime commitment, especially sa mga aspin natin na sometimes hindi na sila nabigyan ng honor or hindi na sila nabigyan ng proper care because some of the owners are focusing na sa merong mga breed. Di po ba? So for me, we advocate for the aspin na it's really their time to shine. So let us love our very own. Kung pwede tayo mag-love ng other breed like yung you said Chow Chow, Shih Tzu, Chihuahua, Husky. Bakit hindi tayo makalove sa sariling atin? So as a member or as an advocate, we really promote the Aspin sa lahat na bagay through adoptions, no? Rescue, advocate, and let us protect also our Aspin, especially kanang sa nasa kalsada. That's why we give justice. And doon pala sa topic, sir, mas na-notice ko, mas cruel ang mga tao ngayon compare before. Because the way you said nga how they killed or how they, you know, euthanized the strays or the aspin, they are only using bitsin or lason. But today, this generation, the people are very cruel. That's why we are here to fight for the animals, right? So thank you so much for this opportunity. And I learned really something. What is ayam talaga? Because never heard you go about ayam. So for the people watching, let's be responsible pet owner. Always follow the five freedoms of animals. And if ever you experience cruelty, please stand for them. Huwag lang tayo maging pipi, bingi, or a bulag for the abuse animal, especially for our aspin. Thank you so much.
Daghang salamat. Thank you very much to the IRO president. So we also admire you for your continued advocacy to defend and to protect and to fight for the welfare of our beloved cats and dogs. So thank you very much for that reaction. So now we have this trivia quiz later, but we would like to prepare your questions and please raise your hand if you want to give your question. And then when you go to the microphone, please introduce yourself when you are recognized. And before that, you would like to read some comments from the Daghan Kaayo. So from Reeve Ryla, how about kanang pag-uwang sa iro during the gabi? So actually that artwork, the title of that artwork is uwang, is howling. So the question from, is this from USJR? Is on site. So I've seen you. I think you have won a quiz. I don't know. Maybe you reacted in some history discussions before. So also a teacher from USJR. So what is this? Kanang pag when the dogs howl. So what does this mean? Or do you have? Anything about this, the howling of the dogs? Audio.
Hello, yan. So, sa Tagalog, at sa Kapampangan din and Bicolano, kapag umaalulong ang aso, may something na mangyayari. Parang may mamamatay, or pagdating naman sa Ilocos daw, nandiyan daw yung mga tiyanak sa paligid. So, parang we associated, our culture associated howling to something bad or an omen of something. So, I'm not sure kung sa Visayas at Mindanao ay ganun din yung perspective. It's a bad omen.
It means something. And also, of course, Father Francisco Alsina mentioned that the dogs in the Visayas do not bark, but they howl and they would simultaneously howl. Di ba you would notice that if you are in the rural area? When a dog would howl, every other dog would also join in. They would have a chorus of howling. And Father Francisco Alsina mentioned it sounds so fearful that you would get scared listening to their howling.
Pero in fairness to the Spaniards, ha? Ito kay ma'am kanina, parang feeling niya yung mga ninuno niyang Espanyol ay masama. No, ma'am. It was an international or a global phenomenon na patayin yung mga aso at that time because walang cure sa rabies. Pero in fairness to the Spaniards, ha, sa tinagal nila sa Pilipinas, before 1800, the August 16, 1800 order of Rafael Mara de Aguilar na patayin yung mga aso, hindi naging reason para sa mga Espanyol ay papatay ang mga aso dahil sa ingay. But when the British invaded Manila, from 1762 to 1764, they killed 10,000 dogs sa Manila. Not because of rabies, ha? Dahil napakaingin nila tuwing gabi. Diba? In fairness to the Spaniards, ha? Never nilang ginawang excuse ang ingay ng aso para patayin. No? And then, when the Americans came, no, during the American colonization in 1898, ginawa rin nila yung pagpatay sa mga aso sa Manila dahil napakaingay nila. Ganun din ang ginawa nila. Pinahiram nila ng stretch 9 yung mga karne. Kinalat sa Maynila. Ang daming namatay. Wala namang utos nun yung mga Amerikanong patayin yung mga aso. Yung mga sundalo na ingayan sa mga aso. No? So, yun yung sa tingin kong aspect ng colonization about howling, no, tuwing gabi. Pero mukhang nasanay na yung mga Pilipino sa howling. Eh. Kung alam, sinasaway na lang natin yung aso. Kapag ganun yung kanilang ginagawa. Kasi nga, iba yung dating sa atin. May something na mangyayari kapag umaalulong sila.
So it means something for the Babaylanes to, it would be the Babaylan who would interpret it. So there is a, so Rod Del Rosario of Maria Asuncion Rodriguez is saying, Tinga High School is saying good afternoon. And Is G. Montes is saying, Sigbin ay panakot talaga sa mga bata nung nasa summer pa ako para di po lumabas ng bahay sa gabi. So it's a story meant to scare children, the Sigbin story, according to S.G. Montes. So Raul is watching. Dana Honrales says, honestly, I love dogs, but it's very funny that every time they bark, I'm so afraid that I have goosebumps. I think I had a fear of phobia with their barking. Can you tell me something to conquer my fear? So have a counseling later with the IRO. Maybe you could schedule counseling. So Dodds Milan from one of our Cebu tour guides is asking, is castration of dogs good or bad? Maybe the IRO or can answer this. Is castration of dogs good or bad? We have our veterinary vet med. May you answer this question? Please introduce yourself. May we have? Yes.
Good afternoon. I am Dr. Verna Agriam, veterinarian 3, animal welfare officer of the Department of Agriculture. The howling of dogs.
Yes.
Okay. The howling of dogs are always because there's someone not familiar to them. There's no barking and there's no unruly behavior for dogs if they are just with the familiar people. But when they smell a foreign smell for them, like for example, what happened sa mga Americans and the British, those are for your Filipino for Aspins, they are really foreigners. No, they don't know them, and it scares the dog. Basic, anything that is unfamiliar scares the dog. That's why they start barking and they start howling. And for can I comment on the rabies?
Yes.
Rabies. During those times, there's really no cure, and it's only killing of the dogs. There's nothing we can do about it. But at this time, we have vaccines, so killing of dogs is not necessary. And even It is a fact that not all people like dogs. And it's also a fact that people can get allergic reaction to dogs. So if you cannot tolerate dogs, just don't get near them. That's all. Because you cannot really force people to love dogs if basically they don't. And we have to accept that fact, that we are just different. There are people who love dogs, who kiss dogs, who eat with them, they share everything with their dogs, but there are just people that just cannot tolerate them. And we just have to accept them as is. But for cure of not liking dogs, don't dare. It won't cure you. There's no cure for it because you just have to accept that fact. Or accept to be beaten. Every time a dog feels your heartbeat, if you are scared of the dog, they will know that you are scared. And the more you're scared with them, they the more that they will put themselves at you, in front of you. If you don't acknowledge these dogs, you will really be in trouble. Because basically dogs needs to be acknowledged. They just really love being called, being touched. So there's no cure for people who doesn't like dogs. That's all.
So there's the question regarding, is castration of dogs good or bad?
For the castration is good because it's for the population and para dili so that there will elimination of birth, and it will decrease aggressiveness. It will also decrease roaming around, so no more strays because they like to stay at home. And it is also found out that they live longer. Castrated dogs or spay dogs live longer.
Daghang salamat. So daghang salamat for the very informative sharing. And of course, we have a veterinary doctor who is with us. We are so happy. So we have this another comment from Rodora Ting. Bits means tight toward the money because the salary takes few weeks. Clarabel is watching from Capitan Eddie Reyes Integrated School, SDO. And Ferdy Pagao Apartisio is saying, Azucena pertaining to dog meat, is this mentioned in your book?
Yes, actually, the thickest, no? Pinakamakapal na chapter sa librong to, Azucena. Just to explain things, no? Na hindi siya madaling, isa siyang problem na hindi, napaka-komplikadong harapin, no? So may cultural aspect, may, yun nga, nagkaroon ng colonial aspect. Parang, ang sabi nga nung isang food historian, dahil kinakantsawan nyo lagi ang mga Pilipino na dog eaters, sige, kakain na rin kami ng aso, parang ganun. So, may mga ganong paliwanag, no? And then, Azucena, actually, it's a play of words, eh. Azucena, actually, it's a flower.
Aso.
It's a flower, no?
A flower, yes.
Pero dahil may Azucena, Cena is food, no? Azucena. So, parang pagkaing aso. And Azucena, it's a general term for dog meat. So, iba-iba yan. Sa Kapampangan daw, yan ay kalderetang style. Sa Bicol, ginataan. So, it's a typical term, ano? Pero yun nga, the mere fact na wala tayong vocabulario, wala tayong indigenous term for dog meat, it's a foreign thing sa atin, no? Na, kung ba parang hindi talaga tayo culturally kumakain ng aso? At least the majority of us, especially the Visayans, historically, hindi talaga kumakain ng aso per alsina, no? So, it's a new thing to us.
Yes.
No? The Azucena.
Yes.
Dahil wala tayong vocabulary. to. Yun yung argument ko doon. No?
Yeah. So there's another question again from our from USJR. if there is a social hierarchy for the Visayans, were the dogs also categorized as dato, timawa, or uripon?
Maybe not. Hindi dahil doon sa strata, but for their use, no, yung kailang pakinabang society. Gaya ka na nabanggit ko kanina, merong term for dogs na hunting talaga. Ito yung pinakamataas na uri ng aso, mga ganid, the hunting dogs, no? And then yung mga asong ano lang, so-so lang, sige, ang ganda ka lang sa bahay, magbantay ka. So ordinary yung aso. And then may mga, yun nga, may sigbin pa, no? Yung sigbin, the mythical one. And then may mga asong, ito yung mga asong gubat, no? Pero not the asong gubat of Mindanao now, no? Kasi talagang based doon sa mga vocabulary ng mga ancestors natin, meron talaga mga wild dogs sa Pilipinas. Inahanap ko ngayon yung word na na-discover ko, pero may wild dogs sa Pilipinas, no? Na nasa gubat lang sila nakatira. Pero hindi ko lang matandaan na yung term. So may mga ganong classifications, not strata, but classifications of dogs. Pero lahat sila, for me, mga aspin lahat sila. Nagkaroon lang ng pagkakataon na iba-iba lang yung kanilang function sa society. Hanggang sa nag-plateau na yung kanilang function. No, hindi na natin ma-distinguish alin yung may hunting prowess, ano yung pambahay lang. Kaya minsan, kapag tinuruan mo raw yung aspin, natitrigger yung kanyang DNA ng pagiging hunting dog. So sana makita natin yung, di ba meron tayong mga bum sniffing dogs, no? So, baka it's about time, although meron na rin naman mga aspin sa mga military dogs, baka pwedeng i-train natin yung mga aspin. Kasi natutulog lang sa kanila yung latent lang sa kanila yung capability nila na maging hunting dogs. No?
Yes. So there is a, Daphne is a live audience. So Daphne, she has a question regarding, would you like to give your question? You wrote your question, but please... tell us your question.
Good afternoon, sir and ma'am.
Introduce yourself.
I am Daphne. I came here independently, and I think that I'm very interested in this because I proudly grew up in the mountains. So I actually tried mangayam. My comments are based on the Cebuano term in relation to hunting. So you mentioned a while ago, sir, that ganid, we also have that word in Bisaya. Ganid is to be thorough, to be accurate, and to be exhaustive. So if a dog is maayumu ganid, so he's a very good hunting dog. And then, and I think that word is very related to ayam because it is also used when hunting. So ayam is hunt. Or to hunt, mangangayam is a person specifically who hunts using or in with the help of dogs. I would like to demonstrate because we have so many dogs at home, and I grew up in the mountains in Cebu City in Cambinocot, and when we play with our dogs in the mountains, so what we do, we throw. We throw a stone towards the game, and we trigger the dog, or we encourage the dog to run after it by saying this. So that's how we do ayam. So we just trigger the dog to run after the game. And I think that our asong gubat is very trained to do that because of the terrain and the foliage that we have in the mountains. And in relation to terms as well, we have other terms that would relate to dogs like kibul, meaning a short-tailed dog. Yes. And then in terms of the idioms also, miss, we have pataka ug paghut. So you're barking at the wrong dog or barking at the wrong tree or pataka ra kag hatag sa imong argument to somebody. And then I think we have a term, sir, I don't know if this is universal, but I learned this around the barangay lang. We have a term called miyat. And I think this would refer to dogs that really could jump really high. And I think that's a very, that's a characteristic for asong gubat. Because they would jump really high. They could climb trees because of their claws. So we have a term for that. We call miyat. I don't know if you have encountered that word. And in addition to all of that, the thing bitay sa iro, I think because we consider dogs as family and we consider dogs and as important, and we Visayans don't eat dogs. So when we say thing bitay sa iro, it means we're in dire straits or we're really in a bad situation that we don't have any other choice but to kill, eat our dogs. And I've seen in my place as well, I've seen some people there who eat dogs. They bitay da iro because they skin the dogs to get the meat. It's also kind of like how they do it with goats. They bitay it or they hang it to get the skin off first, and then they do and they get the meat and cook it. Yeah, that's it. Thank you.
Daghang salamat, Daphne. Daghang salamat for the very precious sharing of your personal experience of ayam. Yes.
Mama Gripina, I just want to share this. Nakita ko na yung term, ano. So, kung sa mga, thank you na mayroon palang word na galit sa Visayas, pero during the colonial times, ang na-record ng mga Spanyol na term for Bisaya, ano, the hunting dog for the Visayas, is mangtas. Buhay pa ba yung word na yon? Mangtas? Ha? Mangtas. Yun ang tawag ng mga sinaunang Bisaya sa hunting dogs. No? And then, ito pa, sa lahat ng hunting dogs, meron din palang level. Ano? So kapag great hunting dog siya sa mga Bisaya, garagaraan ang tawag noong unang panahon. Garagaraan. Ibig sabihin, ito na yung pinaka the best na hunting dog. And then ito pa, sa lahat ng kultura sa Pilipinas, na nangangaso nung colonial period, mga Bisaya lang yung nagbibigay ng medal sa mga aso. Eto, meron silang term, the Bisayan practice of laot or balagon or litid, placing something like collar on a dog. Yun.
Yes. So, thank you very much for that, for clarifying those words. Of course, ang ganid, ganiron, di ba? You are very meticulous about it. So, actually, there are so many reactions from our audience, and time is running out. So, if you have one more or two more questions, yes, we will have from the on-site. So, if you have time, we will read your questions or comments to those online. But we will give first the floor to those on site. Please introduce yourself. And yes.
I'm just going to put Ian on the spot. No, thanks for the book. I haven't read it yet, but I've always wondered. I don't know if your research. My name is.
Please introduce yourself. Please.
I'm Janice. I'm a screenwriter and an author also of a dog book. I want to ask Ian, I've always wondered this. Did we also have Filipino wolves that evolved into dogs? Like, I don't know if your research ever got that far back in time. Pero I always wondered if the Aspin or like even the witch dog, if it really is native talaga. Did that ever happen at the first Filipinos prehistoric way, way, way back? Did we have wolves in the Philippines that somehow became domesticated to and turned into dogs? So I've always wondered that. I just don't know if you were ever, you found that. The
thank
research
you.
Mo.
Daghang salamat, Johnny. So, Ian.
Okay. Actually, based on archaeological finds, no, sa mga nahukay, very recent yung mga aso. Nearly 4,000 years lang compared to China na 10,000, ganyan. And if you are familiar with the latest, no, it's not actually latest, but in the 1960s pa, diribank na yung theory na galing tayo sa Malay Indones. Meron pa po mga naniniwala rito na galing tayo sa Malay Indones. Di ba? Yung ating mga ninuno, no. Austronesians na, no? The ancient seafaring people na galing sa South China, nakita nila yung Taiwan, and then bumaba sa Pilipinas, nag-Indonesia, nag-Malaysia, nag-Madagascar, hanggang Pacific. So, according to Peter Bellwood, one of the anthropologists and archaeologists na nagpakilala ng theory na yon, merong tinatawag na big trees. Big three, tatlong malaki, no? Big three goods. Or daladala ang mga ancestors natin from mainland Asia papunta sa Pilipinas. Manok, baboy, at aso. And roughly around 5,000 years ago or 6,000 years ago, no? I'm not particular with the dating, ano? Dumating sila sa Pilipinas. At tamang-tama lang, yung path nila from Cagayan to Palawan, nandun nakita yung mga earliest domesticated dogs, mukhang ito yung nagja-jibe doon sa theory nila na bago pa man dumating, dala-dala rito ng mga ninuno nating galing mainland Asia, ang mga aso. Therefore, walang aso sa Pilipinas. Ito ay inintroduce nila, kasama nilang dumating sa Pilipinas, no? From mainland Asia. At meron ngayon tinatawag na phylogenetics. Phylogenetics, ito yung tinitrace through mtDNA, mitochondrial DNA, yung pinanggalingan ng mga species. Very accurate, no? So, maaaring kamukha ng aso natin, yung dingo, pero according to DNA, hindi sila related, no? Ito ngayon na nakakatuwa. Yung mga Pacific dogs, galing sa Pilipinas. At yung mga Philippine dogs, yung mga aspin, galing naman sa mainland Asia. Which confirms the theory ng mga archaeologists, anthropologists, decades ago, na bit-bit sila rito ng mga ancient maritime people. So, walang native dogs sa Pilipinas. So, kumbaga, lahat sila ay dinila rito ng mga ninuno natin. Kung bakit may asong gubat, may mga phenomena na ganyan, actually, hindi na bago yung asong gubat, no? In the 1980s, merong napabalita, hinahanap ko yung article, ano, hindi ko nasama sa libro, sa Mindoro, yung mga mangyan, may mga hunting dogs din, the Mindoro hunting dogs, na similar din yung attribute sa mga asong gubat na napabalita ngayon. And then in the early 1900s, nai-record din ni Jenks, no, one of the American ethnographer, yung mga hunting dogs ng Cordillera. At yung mga descriptions ng mga hunting dogs ng Cordillera, ng Mindoro at ng Mindanao, ng bukid noon, magkakamuka. Pero ano ang least common denominator ng Mindoro, Cordillera at Mindanao, especially Bukidnon? Ito mga area ng ito, hindi halos na penetrate ng colonization. So, yung mga ninuno ng mga aso o yung mga hunting dogs na nababanggit sa historical records sa mga Bisaya, Tagalog, Kapampangan, etc., maaaring makita pa natin sa Cordillera, sa Mindoro at Mindanao. Dahil ito mga to, hindi nila namingle yung mga iba't ibang breed. Kasi yung mga aspin natin ngayon, mga mongrels na. Iba-iba na yung lahi ng mga aspin natin. Pero yung build, the same. No? Yung physical attributes. Ngayon, kung gusto mo natin makaaraling palalo, ano yung pristine Philippine dogs, pumunta tayo sa mga indigenous peoples. Sila yung mga, sabihin na natin, hindi nagpailalim sa colonization, na isang catalyst para pumasok yung mga foreign breeds at magkaroon ng mongrelization. Ito mga to na preserve for thousands of years or hundreds or thousands of years, even more, ano? So, yun yung sana mabuksang opportunity ng pag-aaral na to, na balikan natin yung mga indigenous peoples. Sila yung nakapagtago, nakapagtabi, nag-alaga ng mga sinaunang aso ng Pilipinas.
Yes. Thank you very much. It's okay. Daghang salamat to Janice for the question and also for the answer. So, please to our... Is this the last question now from our audience? We have two more. So last na jud ni si Cor. So si Kuanza, are you from USC?
No, actually I'm from Southwestern, but I'm as independent.
Okay.
So I'm actually a veterinary
student. Yes.
Here, Seriam.
Introduce your name.
My name is Seriam Singh. I'm actually a veterinary student from Southwestern University. I believe I may have contacted Sir when the book was actually newly published. I think I reached out to you. Because regarding the Asong Gubats, actually, I was the one who wrote the prototype documents for the Asong Gubats. I worked with the people in Bukidnon, and we're actually trying to collect genetic information on the dogs. Our current theory about the genetic, about the dogs in Philippines is that they may have followed the indigenous peoples to the Philippines through different routes, because you probably know that the indigenous peoples of Philippines may have come from different routes at different periods of time, right? So there our current belief is that the dogs may have followed these different groups of people to Philippines in different points at time. So, so my question is that when it comes to genetics, I'm not sure if this is an appropriate question, but when it comes to genetics, we do believe that maybe just as how there is a strong genetic relationship between the Negritos and the peoples of indigenous peoples of Taiwan, is there a possibility that the dogs of Philippines that are living with the Negritos might be genetically related to those that are existing in Taiwan? And also, what may be the possible hotspots of genetic information that we can collect from these dogs given that there are different indigenous peoples in different parts of the Philippines, where do you think will be good places for us to collect genetic information of these specific dogs? Because we're actually trying to fill in, because Philippines is actually the only country in Southeast Asia that doesn't have a good genetic database when it comes to our dogs. The rest of Southeast Asia actually has it, and we're actually working with these people, and we're trying to figure out where will be the good places for us to collect information.
Thank you. Actually, as I said earlier, the theoretical path of our ancestors from mainland China to Taiwan, down to the Philippines, Indonesia. So I think those paths are pwedeng panggalingan ng mga specimens, no? Especially the Cordilleran dogs. Ito kasi yung mga recorded na napansin nila, kakaiba sila sa mga aspin. But they look aspin pa rin, no? Yeah. Cordillera, Mindoro, and Bukidnon. Yan yung best thing. Mas namimedia lang yung Bukidnon. Pero historically, Cordillera and Mindoro, napabalita na even before the Asong Gubat. Ngayon, tinanong ko yung mga archaeologists kung yung bang mga buto na nakuha sa El Nido, Palawan, the earliest domesticated dogs, pwede ba siyang aralin? Unfortunately, wala pang nag-aaral. So baka po pwedeng yung Cebu dog, noong 1,000 something years ago, the Peña Blanca dog, the prehistoric dogs, pwede nating tingnan yung kailan DNA. Hindi ko alam kung paano dahil historian ako. Hindi ko na purview ang prehistory. Ano? So magandang alamin kung saan pwedeng magtagpo-tagpo itong mga to versus o against dito sa mga existing dogs na meron tayo. And dito rin ko binanggit sa librong to, nag-evolve ang aso from wolves.
Yes, from the Asian Eurasian wolf.
Yes. At sa China yon.
Yeah, from southern China.
Yes, sa China. The earliest dogs evolved in China. Mm-hmm. Doon galing yung mga ninuno natin. Mm-hmm. Especially sa Hoa Binia. There is this archaeological site in South China named Hoa Binia.
Yeah, Hoa Binia.
Na hindi lang mga prehistoric artifacts ang nakuha, skeletal remains ng human. Pati aso.
Mm-mm.
Baka pwedeng i-compare natin yung mga dog remains doon na mas matanda pa sa mga aso sa Pilipinas, baka connected itong mga to. No? So, it's a new thing na sana may mag-aral scientifically kasi ito yung purview ng past na hindi na kayang abutin ng history because we are based on historical records. Mm-hmm. Ito kasi DNA na.
Yeah,
so, the phylogenetics. The phylogenetics. Yes. Ano?
So, daghang salamat. Thank you very much to the student from SWU FINMA. For really coming here and participating in the sharing of knowledge about the dogs in our history. The last but not the least question from our teacher from the University of San Jose Recoleta.
Hi, good afternoon.
Introduce yourself again.
Hi, I'm Karina. I'm an instructor at University of San Jose Recoleta. My question is related to the Filipinos' attitude towards the dogs. I just would like to know, when is the transition from Filipinos being dog lovers to actually being dog abusers, for example? Like, for example, are there certain... Oh, I apologize, hindi ko pa nabasa yung libro. That's why I wanted to ask, are there certain points in our history wherein the transition or the irony of Filipinos loving dogs become Filipinos trying to abuse dogs. Thank you.
Salamat.
Okay. Gusto ko lang linawin na I thank you for the question. Ano? I think it's universal thing na ang tao, ang humanity ay pagmahal sa hayop. No? Wag lang natin siyang solohin na ang Pilipino pagmahal sa hayop. No? It's a universal thing. Nagkataon lang na iba-iba tayo ng kultura. Iba-iba yung degree ng ating regard. Kaya ngayon na-compare ni Alcina, nag-aalaga din naman ng aso mga taga-Europe. Mas mahal naman din siguro nila yung mga aso nila. Pero kakaiba ang mga Bisaya, especially the Bisayans. No? And then, hindi dahil ngayon lang natin na-obserbahan yung mga abuses. Wala nang abuses during the Spanish period. Actually, na-record na ang mga ninuno natin ng abuso rin ng aso. Kaya dito sa libro ko, sa chapter 2, may section dito, cruelty. Like for example, the Tagalogs have this word bagsak. Ibig sabihin, batuhin mo ng bato yung aso. Yung mga Bisaya, mayroong word na balitkun. Batuhin mo ng stick yung aso. Yung mga Bisaya, mayroon ding word na banol. Hampasin mo yung aso ng kahoy. Di ba? And these were recorded in the 1600s by Mateo Sanchez. No? And then, ito pa yung pinakamatindi, hindi ko ma-imagine, yung mga Kapampangan. Meron palang word na mga Kapampangan in 1732 na na-record, na word na mituwati. The root word is kohete, no? Nilalagyan mo ng kohete. Kohete is the Spanish word for kuitis. Yung kuitis natin nang galing sa kohete, Spanish word for fireworks. Ang ginagawa ng mga Kapampangan noon, tinatalian ng kuitis yung buntot ng aso. So ako, as a historian, ayaw kong itago itong mga to. Tama si ma'am, kailangan ma-expose itong ganitong mga bagay na hindi limited sa panahon natin ng abuse. May pang-abuso rin noong unang panahon. It's a cross generation. Pero yun nga, meron pa ba tayo nababalitang naglalagay ng kuitis sa buntot ng aso sa Pilipinas? Thank God, wala na. No? Pero namatay na yung ganong pagtitrip. No? And then the Visayans, may sariling word ang mga Visayans sa pakiramdam ng aso kapag nasasaktan na. Arilil. Di ko alam kung ginagamit yung word na yung arilil. So according to Mateo Sanchez, ito ay yung murmur ng aso kapag nasasaktan na. So may sariling word ang mga Bisaya sa asong nakakaramdam ng sakit. No? Arilil. So yun po yung sagot ko. So it's a cross-generation pala ang pananakit at pang-abuso sa aso. No?
Yes, but there could have been a punishment. Well, we don't know yet if there is a punishment for,
yung kasing,
for people who hurt.
Well, it's a new convention na magkaroon ng animal welfare. The 19th century yes. Na lang. Pero ito, masingit ko lang ma'am. Di ba nagkaroon ng utos na patayin ng mga aso? Pero nagkaroon ng soberness, naging sober yung humanity sa pagpatay sa aso. No? Noong 1850s, si Queen Isabella II, the Queen of Spain, no? Our queen, ano? Naglabas siya ng royal order sa buong Spanish Empire about dog protocol. Kapag na-translate ko sa English 'yon, at pag binasa mo yung order ni Queen Isabella, para siyang nanay na nakikipag-usap sa iyo. It's first person. Siya na nakikipag-usap sa kanyang mamamayan sa Espanya paano mag-alaga ng aso, especially kapag nandiyan yung rabies. At ang sabi niya, pinag-utos niya na huwag patayin ang mga aso ng basta-basta. Hintayin nating mag-exhibit sa isang aso ang rabies. At ang sabi pa niya, huwag daw nating i-discriminate yung mga stray dogs. Maaari daw na yung asong binibigyan mo ng pagmamahal sa loob ng bahay ay may rabies din. Di ba? So, dumating sa point na yung Spain, nagkaroon ng ganong policy na huwag patayin basta-basta yung aso. Up until such time, nag-exhibit siya ng rabies. So, may mga ganong moments sa world history, ano? Hindi lang Philippine history, na naging humane ang tao. Hanggang saan marating natin yung panahon natin ngayon na lahat ng pwedeng ideal na humane na pag-aalaga o pagtrato sa hayop, ginagawa natin. So, we are products of history kung bakit tayo ganito ngayon. Pero wag nating usgahan yung mga nauna sa atin, ba't ganun kayo ka-brutal? Ano? Yun sila. At dumating sa point na nag-evolve ang humanity, nagde-develop, nagiging makatao. No?
Dehen salamat Ian. So that's the last question. So there is a question actually, but in the middle of the trivia quiz, I would read it. So we have this question with exciting prize. So the first one to raise his or her hand would go to the microphone to answer the question. And when you answer this, so we have two questions. One is for the on-site audience, and the second is for both on-site and online. But you would all answer through the comment section of the Facebook Live event. So the first question is this. The prize is our cake of the month, Gugmatic cake, which is Gugmang Poetic, not Gugmang Attic. You deserve the Gugmang, the poetic love, not the Attic love. So if you are able to answer this, you would win the Gugmatic cake, our cake of the month. A cake full of love with basil, oregano, and strawberry. So the question is this. The one who would be the judge if your answer is correct would be our resource person. So when was the earliest documented existence of dogs in the Philippines? How many years ago? Please, it's very easy. So you raise your hand and you go to the microphone. So how many years ago was the earliest documented existence of dogs? That's the first. Pwede round off. You round off to the nearest 1,000. Yeah, raise your hand. And sige si, Regional Director of PhilPIDA, the Philippine Fiber Development Authority, Joseph, please go to the microphone. Sige. The first one to, yes, go to the mic. Huh? Congratulations! Wala na mo, Juan, ha? Grabe rin taga Philippine Fiber Development Authority. They are very keen listener. You haven't read the book. Oh, yes. So that's the earliest was 3,900 something, or round off. We round it off to 4,000 years ago, the earliest. The congratulations to win a Gugmang Poetic Cake with strawberry, basil, and oregano. So the next question is you would answer through the comment section of this Facebook Live event. Do you have your internet? So it's a very easy question, and you will win an Instagrammable and relaxing Kawa bath with an oration from our modern day Babaylan of our Alima native massage. You can have a flower of buwak hulumkawa or a tinua. You can have tinula hulumkawa with ginger, sea salt, and it's at our Hardin Dagami. So you would win a hulumkawa when you answer this question at the Facebook Live event. So for those online, so they also answered the first question, actually. So the question is very easy. Give the title of the book that tells about how the Philippine culture loves dogs. So, night clue, authored by Ian Alfonso. So I would like, while you are answering the question, there is a question, Ian, we would like to give you this question from Rod Del Rosario. Is there, there is a question from Rod that we would like you to answer. Well, they are typing their answers to the question of what is the title of the book? Is there any famous ayam or dog in our historical records that stand out like Hachiko of Japan and Lassie of the U.S.? So we would be looking at your answers. Who was the first to the very fast fingers? Abtikpas iro mo kuan mo type sa answer. So while we are so Ian, is there a famous dog or ayam in history? This is from Rod Del Rosario that stand out like Hachiko of Japan or Lassie of the U.S.
Yes. In terms of loyalty, we have Tigre. He predated Hachiko, no, for 30 years, no. So in 1903, sa San Fernando, Pampanga, there was this revolutionary governor Pampanga, like Arcadio Maximo of Cebu, no? Tiburcio Hilario died due to scarlet fever. And then meron siyang aso, hindi namin alam kung anong breed, no? Basta na-record siya. Tigre pangalan. Nung inilibing na yung amo niya, ipinamigay nung asawa yung aso. Dahil nakikita lagi nung asawa niya sa aso na yun, naalala niya lagi yung asawa niya, yung namatay na asawa. Pinamigay yung aso. And Tiburcio Hilario was buried in Bacolor, Pampanga. And they were residing in San Fernando, Pampanga. I think medyo malayo-layo. I think parang mga 12 kilometers, 15 kilometers din yung layo. Laging nakakawala yung aso doon sa pinagpasahan kay Tigre. Alam mo saan nakikita ng pamilya lagi yung aso? Sa puntod ni Tiburcio Hilario sa Bacolor. Tapos daw, kapag daw dumadaan daw yung aso sa bahay nila, tumatahol lagi doon sa bahay. Parang minumura daw yung pamilya, ba't niyo ako pinamigay? Parang gano'n. Alam mo, namatay din yung aso after 2 weeks dahil hindi kumakain. And to honor Tigre, in 2003, San Fernando City Government exhumed the remains of Don Tiburcio Hilario. Di ba nagkalahar ang Pampanga? Yung Bacolor na lubog sa lahar, hinukay pa nila ng ilang metro yung puntod niya. Di nila sa San Fernando at nagtayo ng isang monumento. Kung kilala niyo si Toim Imaw, one of our sculptors, Toim Imaw, no? Natouch siya dun sa kwento ni Tigre. Ang kanyang kontrata lang sa gobyerno, magtayo ng monumento ni Don Tiburcio. Alam niyo anong ginawa niya? Naglagay pa siya ng monumento ni Tigre sa base ng monumento. Hindi yung kasama sa bayad, I think. Parang natouch lang sa kwento. Parang ni-reunite niya, yung artist, ni-reunite niya si Tigre doon sa kanyang amo kasi nandoon sa pedestal na yon yung remains si Don Tiburcio. Kaya si Tigre nandoon sa monumento ni Don Tiburcio sa San Fernando, Pampanga. Parang siya nagbabantay, nakahiga lang siya katabi nung amo niya. So I think that is the closest to Hachiko, no?
Yes.
Nasa libro.
It's in the book. So, but unfortunately, it's not as famous as Hachiko. It's famous in maybe in Luzon, but
no, not even famous in Pampanga. Hindi ko nga alam. Hindi ko alam kung not kung di ko lang ginawa yung libro, di ko malalaman yung kwento na yon.
So daghang salamat for that. So our winner for the first one, with the fastest, mas paspas pa kaysa iro. Mas paspas pa kaysa ayam. So our winner for the Hulum Kawa to giving the title of the book, which is Dogs in Philippine History. So the one who was the first to answer is Kitch Dean Santinyaman. Is this on? Are you here? Wow, the teacher from the St. Louis College of Mandaue City. Dagang salamat. Congratulations for having the fastest finger to type the correct answer. So now, as we end our discussion, our conversations this afternoon, we would like to have the closing statement from our author and our resource person, Ian Alfonso.
Okay. Once again, thank you very much for this opportunity, Mama Grifina. This is the third time, I think, na nag-lecture ako dito, nag-guest. And salamat din po sa oras na nandito po kayo. And hopefully, I think ang pinunta nyo rito, hindi naman ako, yung libro. No? Sana supportahan nyo yung libro. And parting words, wala tayong word, walang Philippine word sa any kultura natin to explain yung gesture natin na bigla lang na sa harap ng bahay natin or sa tindahan, maglalagay tayo ng plato na may dog food or may tubig. Parang kusang loob na lumalabas sa atin yun. Ano? I think kaya siguro wala tayong term for that dahil ang aso ay parang tao din, pakikipagkapwa. Hindi man natin maalagaan yung aso o maampon, mabigyan man lang sila ng pagkain sa harap ng bahay natin o tubig, nag-extend tayo ng ginhawa o ng kaya doon sa aso sa paligid. Wala tayong term for that gesture eh, pero ginagawa natin culturally, no? At hindi mo na kailangan i-explain ng napaka-academic bakit mo ginagawa yon. It's innate to a Filipino. And then in 1889, there was this lexicographer named Pedro Serrano Lactao na na-record niya yung isang Spanish word, ha, humiram pa tayo ng word to explain that gesture, no, yung ating ganong gawi. And the word is pero, perero, not the chocolate, ha, perero, P-R-E-R-O, perero. Sa Spanish, ang ibig sabihin ng perero, tagapagbugaw ng aso. It's a church responsibility ng mga layperson when Christianity was introduced to the Philippines. At ang ginagawa ng mga perero, palayasin ang mga aso tuwing misa. Pero bakit noong 1889, iba na yung meaning? Hindi kaya yung mga perero na ninuno natin sa mga simbahan, instead na taboy ang mga aso, inampun na lang nila. Dahil noong 1889, ang ibig sabihin ng perero sa dictionary ni Laktaw ay taong maibigin mag-ampon ng aso. Nag-evolve na yung meaning from the Spanish word. So sana maging perero tayo, ano? O pag-ampon sa aso, ano? Yun.
Maraming salamat. So a round of applause once again to our resource person for this very exciting, enlightening discussion this afternoon. And he would be very much willing to sign the books if you have bought a book. And of course, we also have his book, Sarangani Island, The History of Sarangani. He is the author of the book on the nameless warrior in the Battle of Bangkusay, but it's out of print. We wanted to have that, so it's the battle in Manila when the Spaniards went to Manila after they came to the Visayas. So daghang salamat, congratulations to all the winners, and thank you very much for joining us. We're so happy with your participation and also the insights that you shared, and to our reactors from the IRO and also from the Carolinian Political Science Society. We invite you once again to another stimulating discussion on February 14, Iyot Og Relihiyon, tracing the physical intimacies and religion from pre-colonial to modern Visayas. And so, daghang salamat to our partners, USC Carolinian Political Science Society, Island Rescue Organization, Tres de Abril Foundation, Central Visayas Association of Museums, the Yandi Heritage Center, SOAN 2020. Maayong hapon natong tanan. So, asa kamusta?